Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda this morning is the Additional Support for Learning Inquiry. And this is our fourth formal session on this topic, which we will now be considering, where we consider how the Education Additional Support for Learning Scotland Act 2004 has been implemented and how it is working in practice some 20 years on. Today we will hear from two panels of witnesses and we will be focusing on three themes throughout the inquiry: the implementation of the presumption of mainstreaming, the impact of COVID-19 on additional support for learning, and the use of remedies as set out in the Act. And today we're going to focus mainly on the first and third themes, but I'm sure we will likely touch on the second theme as well. So can I welcome our first panel? We have Megan Farr, Policy Officer from Children and Young People's Commissioner in Scotland; David Mackay, Head of Policy, Projects and Participation, Children in Scotland; and Marie Harrison, Senior Policy Officer from My Rights, My Say, Children in Scotland; and lastly but not least, Chloe Minto, Senior Solicitor from the Govan Law Centre. Welcome and thank you for your written submissions you've provided ahead of the meeting today, and we're going to move straight to questions from members. And can I first bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning and thank you very much for joining us, and also for sending the information you already have in advance. It's been hugely helpful. I just have one very broad opening question, which is this. Why do you think parents have to fight all the time? What is the root cause of the difficulties they and their children and young people face when accessing education?
Who'd like to go first? Thank you, Megan.
I think there's two things. I think the first is around something that comes up absolutely consistently every time there's a review on them, and there's been a really large number of reviews in this area in the last 10 years, Angela Morgan's probably being the most comprehensive, and that's around resourcing, and that's resourcing in terms of people a lot of the time, so it's particularly enough support day-to-day in the classroom. It isn't something that, I'm trying not to jump onto mainstreaming here, it's difficult not to. I think what we're seeing now is that the result of 15 years of austerity, possibly actually longer, of reducing budgets, and decisions have been made within that area of having austerity about what resources are put towards ASN and how those resources are deployed. And I think it is really concerning that they've sometimes not been prioritised, or there's been prioritisation which isn't aimed at meeting the rights of all children. In human rights terms, there's a duty on the state, and that means Scottish Government, that means local authorities, that means other organisations, health boards particularly around allied health professionals. It also means UK Government to ensure that resources are used to the maximum extent possible to realise children's rights. And I think what we're seeing across the UK, our colleagues in the other Commissioner's offices have made similar comments about resourcing in ASN as one area where there hasn't been the prioritisation, and what we're seeing now is the outcome of that. I think the other reason that parents have to fight is that actually there's a massive gap in terms of right to remedy with additional support needs. We have a really good mechanism, and May gave evidence here last week and was really clear about how her tribunal works, but it's only available to a very small number of people, because it's only available to those who either qualify for a CSP, whether or not they get one, or where there's a disability discrimination case. I was really concerned looking at the SPSO response, and this is not a criticism of them because I think actually they're right, that they wouldn't expect to get complaints on ASL, but actually if they're not going to the tribunal and they're not going to the SPSO, and that's what SPSO have said in their written evidence, where are complaints going? Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the parents having to fight has come from, is there's actually no effective way of challenging decisions around children's additional support needs. So that's a brief answer.
Marie Harrison.
Thank you. I think the whole field of additional support needs as well is very, very wide, and I think there might be a tendency for everybody from policy level and all the way down to school level to think about children with additional support needs as a minority or as a very small group of children and young people. And as such, we try to do inclusion as if we're talking to a very small cohort of children, but we're not. We're talking about 37%, I think was the last number, 241,000 plus children with additional support needs in education. So I think, to answer your question, there are so many children and young people, and I think in order for inclusion and for education to be meaningful to all of these children and young people, we need to acknowledge that this is a very wide field, and we're not talking about a small number of children. We're talking about more than a third of the children and young people in Scottish schools. So I think that we need to sort of consider some kind of a cultural shift where instead of thinking about those children and those children, we need to think about all our children. So it's just to make that wee point.
Chloe.
Yes. I think in particular around awareness of the duties that education authorities have and training of local authorities to ensure that all of their staff understand what the rights of children with additional support needs are is very important. We at Govan Law Centre are able to provide free training to local authorities. Unfortunately, this is not something that is picked up on. We are very pleased to be providing training to MSP caseworkers next week, and we hope that that will be a very positive shift in ensuring that duties are understood. However, we do remain concerned that we consistently have to reiterate what the duties are on an education authority to the authority. A lot of these cases don't even end up at tribunal because sometimes it's as clear as they simply didn't know. And once they have that information, you see adjustments been put into place. I think we see it particularly around disability discrimination claims. And once they see the things they should be doing, then we tend to see them happening. So I think that's a big one for us.
And David.
Thank you. Yeah, and I think it's interesting the language used, which certainly came across in the Morgan Review, that idea of parents fighting for their children's rights. I think we're obviously not currently getting it right, and the issue is that children and young people aren't experiencing their rights under UNCRC, especially Article 12, Article 28, Article 29. I think Megan's touched on resources and the amount of funding and staff time and training there is therefore for staff, which I think is a kind of key issue. And it also links into communication with parents and carers and the impact of tight resources limiting teacher or support workers' time to have for communication, for planning, and really working together effectively, because then it leads to that kind of culture where it feels like a fight rather than actually working together. And that's something that we hear quite a lot through the Inquire helpline. A large proportion of our calls are actually focused on communication between parents and carers. And in many cases, we find that there's a relationship breakdown when actually it's just poor communication rather than, you know, in many cases, the school are doing their best, are putting supports in place, are supporting children and young people effectively, but then that communication, that clarity about what's happening within the school environment isn't clear between all partners, so the young person, the parents and carers, and the school kind of working together. So I think that's kind of key challenge that we need to overcome.
Thank you. And I'll resist the temptation to talk about CSPs and resources, because I know other colleagues are going to do the same. Are going to talk about that. Why do you think that communication is breaking down, and what do we need to change to make sure that everybody knows who should be communicating what at the right point to whom?
David.
I think school staff are really stretched out with what they've got to deliver, and we've seen the sort of lack of time for, I guess, peer learning discussion, discussion with colleagues, and then making that time to reach out to families. That's a really time-intensive but important part of the process. And so when education professionals feel that they're pulled in lots of different directions, I think often, and we've heard from some of the previous evidence given to the committee, that there's this focus on making sure that the child in front of them is getting the right support in school, and that they're prioritising that direct work with the child or young person. And so I think it's important that that bigger picture, there's enough time for staff to be able to take that step back, think about how frequently they're communicating with home, with parents and carers, and the bigger picture, that kind of network. I don't know if you have some more to say, Marie.
Marie and then Chloe. Yeah,
thanks. I was just going to add, and I'm sure this will come up again later, but I think training is still lacking when it comes to sort of meaningful ways of engaging and supporting children and young people. It's something within the My Rights, My Say service we work very, very hard at, and we know that if you want to build positive relationships with families and with parents, you need to start by building a positive relationship with the child. In order to build a positive relationship with a child that has additional support needs, you need to invest a lot of time, and you need to have a level of expertise around how to communicate in positive ways. It can come down to things like language. We hear children as well who are saying that they're being called aggressive, for example. If you call a child aggressive, that's going to be really hurtful, and that's going to make that child take a stance against whoever said that. So I think there's still language being used that is detrimental to children's desire to have positive relationships with school staff. And we have heard recently, spoke to a young person who said, I've just checked out. So there's a lack of trust for some children and young people because they feel that they're the ones being blamed for the issues they're experiencing in school. It's almost like the onus is on the child to change to fit into the school box rather than the school box being willing to change around the child. So again, it's about this culture shift, trying to focus on the culture, trying to focus on the structures and why they are not working for the child, rather than looking at the child and the family as the ones that need to change. A child with additional support needs can't change their makeup. They are who they are, and they have value, they have rights, and they are they can contribute in so many ways. But in order for them to do that, we need to be willing to not just ask them questions, but to actually listen to what they're telling us. And I think, as David touched on, the resources are stretched, so it can be very hard to invest that time and energy in the children and young people that they deserve. And if it fails there, then it's not going to work for the parents either. And then you have this very cataclysmic relationship on your hands where parents lose trust as well. And I think that's what happens a lot. I think our local authorities and schools want to do the best they can for children and young people. I don't think there's anyone out there who wants children to fail or to not be happy or to not attain or achieve and feel happy in school. But I think the landscape just is such that there's a lot of mistrust on all sides. I think local authorities are trying, you know, have to somehow spread themselves very thinly, and parents want more than the local authorities are willing to give or able to give. And then you end up with this very, I would almost go as far as to say, hostile working environment where everybody feels unhappy, teachers feel de-skilled, and children feel that they can't trust anyone.
On that particular point.
I think I'm very aware of you encroaching into other areas of questioning again.
Okay.
All right, that's okay. Chloe, you want to respond to that?
Thank you. Marie mainly covered the points I wanted to make about ensuring that the child is at the heart of things. I think in terms of communication breakdown, what we tend to see, and I know that Ms Dunsmuir commented on it in her evidence session, is masking. We see that in almost every single tribunal case that we're taking forward. We're having questions about, why? Why is the child so different at home than school? Why are they stimming at home and why are they not in school? What is the root cause of that? And there aren't enough questions being asked about that by the education system. And that leaves parents feeling very failed. And I suppose that adds into that fight that we see. They feel like there's a blame apportioned onto them that is something to do with them. They're only seeing it in the home space. So I do think masking is a really central part. And I think that education authorities need to take more responsibility in terms of that. We shouldn't be settling for a child behaving entirely differently or presenting entirely differently at home than at school.
Thank you. Megan, have you got something briefly to add to this?
Very briefly. I hope I can get an opportunity to come back to
we will,
comment about the school.
The conversations will be extensive throughout the day, so some of the threads will be picked up later on.
Yeah. In terms of communication, I think there is something about language and about how we talk about children with additional support needs, particularly ones who are distressed. That's come through in some of the narrative about behaviour in the last year or so. And in terms of, if you look at the exclusion statistics. They're disproportionately children with additional support needs. And I think if that narrative probably has not been helpful in terms of relationships between school, and it probably also though reflects the way that some parents are hearing about their children or are hearing their children described.
Megan. Yes, as I said, we've got a... Hopefully you'll find that as the conversation develops, you will get the chance to make all of the points that you're desperately trying to do at the moment. So can I bring in Michelle Thompson, please?
Good morning, everybody. Now, we've already started to touch on this area, but I'm interested in how the concept of a rights-based approach can facilitate decisions on how money is spent to support all pupils. So, I mean, I think we've had some very good submissions about a rights-based approach, and I'll probably come to you first, Megan, but I am interested in how where a balance needs to be struck, how money, the filthy lucre, kind of starts to affect decision-making. So perhaps we could start with you, Megan.
Thanks. Inevitable it was going to come to me first. I think just to go back to the point I made earlier about what those duties in the UNCRC mean, and although the Incorporation Act has only become an act this year, the UK government, the UK Parliament, made a commitment to those obligations in the UNCRC when they ratified it in 1991. So these are really long-standing commitments around realising children's rights and using resources to the maximum extent possible in the world's sixth largest economy. So that's the context for it. It then comes down to how individual decisions are made, and those individual decisions are made at all levels of government, UK government, Scottish government, here in Parliament, and in councils across Scotland. And we know that all of them are making tough decisions and have been doing so for probably two decades, certainly for 15 plus years. So in order to take a rights-based approach to budgeting, there's been a lot of work done in the last few years and quite a lot of it by SHRC, our colleagues literally upstairs for us, have done a lot of work around human rights-based budgeting more broadly. There's also been work done by our office and by others around children's rights budgeting. Scottish Government have the Children's Rights and Wellbeing Impact Assessment, CREA, which is a tool which can be used as part of budget setting. It is difficult to see how it is used. It's difficult to see whether it's used consistently. It's we see some extremely good CREAs coming from government parts of government, and not always the ones you'd expect. We then see some which are very which lack detail, which appear to have been done, or it's very clear that they've been done after decisions have been made. That's not how they should work. We quite often see consultations from Scottish Government that say, have you got any information for your CREA? We should be getting a draft CREA with a consultation. It sometimes feels like they're asking respondees to do the CREA for them, and that's not how it should be. In terms of local government, I did a bit of a dip into local government budget setting a couple of years ago now as part of this work, and again, it was really inconsistent. And I think the other thing that I was concerned about was how much information elected members get. Sometimes in the budget packs that councils gave their councillors, there was simply a yes or no that an EQIA had been done. CREAs were much less visible. So the mechanisms are there, and it is about impact assessing, and it is about doing that with a mind always to what are the obligations, and particularly with incorporation coming into force in July, these will be legal obligations, and there'll be legal obligations to deliver an education for children that meets not only Article 28, which is the right to an education, but also Article 29, which talks about development of a child's personality, talents, mental and physical abilities to their fullest potential. And I think we're not doing that for far too many children at the moment.
Okay, I mean, I sense everybody else in the panel wants to... excuse me, I've got a bit of a chesty cough today, so you'll have to put up with that. But I'd like to bring everyone else in the panel, and also focusing on... Because I think you've given us a very good articulation of what... But I'm also interested in the how the flow of money affects rights-based approach. Marie.
correct me if I'm straying here, but I think one of the really important things to consider when you want to deliver a rights-based approach, not just to funding but to life in general, is the how. Yeah. At the moment, we're in a situation where we have a lot of remedies for 12 to 15-year-olds under the ASL Act. In July, we're going to get the full set of delivery on the UNCRC Incorporation Act, and I personally am not... I'm not convinced that I fully understand how the two are going to be compatible. At the moment, delivering on the My Rights, My Say service, we're able to support a cohort of children to exercise their rights. So very much we're funded by Scottish Government to ensure that 12 to 15-year-olds can exercise the rights they've been given under the ASL Act. That's 13 rights. The CRC is 54 rights, or condensed into 42 potentially, that would directly impact children and young people. And I think it's really important that we don't just implement policy or legislation. There has to be some kind of mechanism to support this in real life, not just for children, but for their families and for the professionals who are going to be dealing with these issues as well. And I'm not sure what that is going to look like, if it's going to be a similar structure to My Rights, My Say. I can just conclude that through the work we do, the ASL Act, we can respond to those children, but again, 241,000 children with additional support needs. My Rights, My Say has supported around 1,000 over the 6 years that we've been active. And it's not to say that all 241,000 would have needed our support. A lot of children with additional support needs cope very well within their education settings. But I do think that we're scratching the surface still. Mm. And we have to sort of acknowledge that in a few months' time, more rights are coming. And there has to be some kind of allocation of funds to ensure that those rights are not just pretty on paper and not just sort of a flagship that we can pull out to say we have done this. We suffer from implementation fatigue sometimes, and we need to get over that. We need to really make sure that this is achievable and accessible for children and young people and families and professionals alike.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if Chloe and David, you want to come in, but this concept of complexity over the existing rights, plus, as you point out, new ones coming in. I don't know if you want to add anything, Chloe.
Yes, I think I would echo that it's extremely important that we look at how this is going to be put into place. And again, some of our figures highlight that we are only scratching the surface. Now, our government funding is expansive. We are the government service that allows any parent or young person that has a right of reference to take their case forward to the tribunal. Now, we've heard the number of how many children with additional support needs there are, and we've only had around about 624 files in the past 5.5 years. Now, that is not for the lack of us trying, and I think particularly when we looked after children, we have only had 8 files in the past 2 years for looked after children. That's an extreme concern to us, and that is a group where we're seeing rights not being realised. Mm-hmm. So I celebrate what's about to happen, and I'm very hopeful that we'll see some very fruitful progress in the space for children. However, I do have some concerns and reservations about how children are going to access mm-hmm. those rights. Mm-hmm. I have another point to make about the presumption of mainstream and a best interest test, but I think I'll leave that for just now. I imagine we'll circle back.
Yeah, we'll get a row if we stray off topic.
Yes.
Quickly, because yeah. I can see others are keen to come in on some points. Just in terms of Children in Scotland, worked alongside Carnegie and Catanach a couple of years ago to do some work around child rights-based approaches to budgeting, which I'd be happy to share with the committee. And then the other thing is, I mean, there's lots of other resources that the UN have produced around taking a child's rights approach. Important thing is to sort of consider that participation and transparency and accountability as part of that process. And when I'm talking about participation, we're talking about individual decision making, so decisions at an individual level, but also those mechanisms to then influence sort of wider policy, broader policy. So it's not just necessarily about their own lives, it's about how education is delivered. So I think those kind of meaningful and broad participation of children and young people, so it's not just a really narrow targeted group of young people, there's kind of much wider opportunities for that engagement, I think, is important.
And I keep catching your eye, Megan. I don't know if you've got a final point on this without straying into other territory.
I was going to come in on participation, so I'm glad David said most of it already, but actually there's been a really recent and really concerning instance of that, and that is around behaviour in schools, where actually there has been very little engagement with children and young people. There's been a lot of effort put into engagement with various groups of adults around it, and we can't make decisions, and that applies to budgeting, but it happens that applies to all other areas of policy making as well, is that it's not rights-based if it's not involving the children. Okay. And that, as David said, it's a broad range of children. It can't be tokenistic. There are groups of children who do fantastic jobs, the inclusion ambassadors you'll hear about, I'm sure, but it needs to go broader than that. It needs to be the children who are actually being affected by policies, who are being consulted with. And that's another gap in terms of CREA we see a lot.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle Thompson. We've spoken a little bit there about the presumption of mainstreaming, but I'm trying to figure out as well and ask some questions around what role the specialist school settings have in our system when it comes to that presumption of mainstreaming. Because we heard from Matthew Kavanagh from the Scottish Secondary Teachers Association that they have a real opportunity to really have the better ability, I think he said, to meet the needs of individual pupils whom they know better. So I was wondering what you thought the role of those specialist settings might be in the presumption of mainstreaming, and what are the criteria for when that specialist setting is appropriate and is understood and consistently applied? So that would be helpful. Do you want to come in first, Maria? So you've caught
my eye. I'm happy to. I think primarily the specialist schools, we see absolutely wonderful practice. We see wonderful practice in mainstream schools as well. We see a lot of commitment, but I think one of the things that could maybe be utilised more is some kind of learning exchange, and is trying to support mainstream schools to learn from specialist settings what it is they're doing, what it is that works really well for them, and how we can sort of take some of that good learning and try to transfer it into mainstream settings as far as that's possible. So some kind of continued professional learning, try to see if there's scope to sort of deliver on that. I think we're still seeing that mainstream schools don't have the facilities that specialist provisions have. They are different settings. They are, in some ways, I suppose, trying to deliver on an inclusion agenda that the school's physical makeup are not built for, whereas you have the specialist schools that are specifically built with children with additional support needs in mind. So I don't think this will bridge everything, but I think trying to do some kind of collaboration and then create opportunities there would be really important.
And on that, before I bring the other members in, unashamedly, I'll have a little, Curry Community High School has Woodland Specialist School next to it, and it was my old head teacher at Melvin that had the inspiration to put them so close together, so there is that sharing. So I was wondering if you're aware of any other, as we're hearing evidence from the rest of the panel, if you've got other opportunities like that, and maybe comment on how that might work for parents, pupils and staff, because it does have that collaboration. So we'll bring in Megan and then we'll come to David and Chloe.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to turn the question on head a little bit because the UN Committee on the Rights of People with Disabilities, a definition of a disability, which the Committee on the Rights of the Child has adopted as theirs, so also applies to the UNCRC, so will effectively become part of Scots law on July the whatever it is, talks about a long-term physical, mental, intellectually or sensory impairment which, and I'll emphasise this, but in interaction with various barriers may hinder their full and effective participation in society on an equal basis with others. And in terms of talking about mainstreaming, what that means is that actually, if talk about additional support needs, there's a large proportion of that 37% of children with additional support needs who maybe don't need to have additional support needs. But because the barriers that they are experiencing in the school are needing additional support. So there is something about...
Example to help us understand.
Yeah, so particularly secondary schools, and particularly the newer build secondary schools, are often very large open spaces. They're very noisy, they're very bright. When there's lots of children moving around, they're very crowded, and particularly children with an autistic spectrum disorder can find that extremely overwhelming, and sometimes the adaptation they need is very small. It's taking them out of their busier bits of the rooms, but we're still designing schools like that. There's a number of primary schools that were built around four class clusters in a block with no walls. Those ones are also really difficult environments. So in terms of that, in terms of another example, if schools aren't physically adapted for disabled children, then they need additional support to get around the school because the school doesn't have level access. So there's a couple of examples around that.
And I know we've got some questions around buildings later on. I'm straying.
But buildings is a factor, but school cultures is a factor as well. And sometimes just fairly minor changes. And you go into schools, we visit schools fairly regularly. You go into ones that you can see children who are autistic children absolutely joining in with the rest of the class and not experiencing those barriers because the school meets their needs sort of automatically because of the way the school's run. You go into others where you can see them just not coping with aspects of the school day. So flipping mainstream a little bit on the head in that I think we've got an issue where mainstreaming is not meeting the needs of a big chunk of children that it should.
Okay.
But in terms of special schools, there's definitely still a role for specialist provision. Your example of Woodlands is a really good one because it doesn't need to be a separate school. It could be a unit, it could be enhanced provision, it could be a model where a child spends part of their time in mainstream classes, part of their time in specialist provision. So the other issue around specialist schools is that we do have some really highly specialist schools in Scotland which are attended by some of the children with the most complex disabilities, and particularly the Doran Review, the grant-aided special schools. Those schools have been sort of in limbo with their funding for a good dozen years or so now. They do an amazing job. That's a group of children who are never going to be in mainstream. Mainstream is never going to be able to meet their needs. They've got very complex medical conditions, often as well as disabilities. There is some work being done to share some of that expert knowledge that comes from those schools with mainstream, but that's a growing number of children. It's a growing number of children for a good news story. Children are surviving medical conditions like that now into adulthood, and that's an area where there will always be a place for specialist schools.
Thank you. I suppose I'm trying to drill down around that. If there is specific criteria, and I'm sort of, you know, I know that sounds a bit brutal when we're talking about our young people to talk about things in that way, but what the criteria for when a specialist setting is appropriate and what's bad. So can I bring Chloe in on that first, please? Thanks.
Yes, so we deal with the placing request refusal. So that would be where a parent has applied for their child to attend a specialist provision. Now, rather than there being a positive criteria, it's essentially the local authority can select from 12 grounds of refusal to see why the special provision would not be appropriate. That can be things like capacity. It may be that the school is not suited to the ability and aptitude of the child. And all of these are on top of the presumption of mainstream being one of the reasons that they can be refused. Now, one thing that I would say is that when the local authority issue these letters, there's not a lot of information there. So if we're relying on a ground of refusal such as the special school is not suited to the child due to the ability and aptitude of the other children in the school, what would be really helpful at that stage would be for more of an understanding as to why, you know, parents are not wanting to push their children into a provision that's not right for them. But we need that transparent conversation and dialogue to ensure that we get the child in the right space. Often we have difficulties in trying to get parents through the door of the special school to see it and to see what their child would be experiencing. So that is essentially the way that it works. Sometimes local authorities will set their own criteria and say this school is for complex needs children, they may use the term, or they may say that this is a school for children with intellectual disabilities. That is simply just local authority criteria, and when we're at the tribunal, what we would be arguing is whether the ability and aptitude of the children match the child that we're looking at, rather than any external criteria that the local authority have tried to apportion to a school. What's important is the pupil profile that we see in front of us. And I do think there's a place for special provisions. The language I do find jarring that we still use the phrase special school. That is the phrase that is in our legislation, and the only reason that that's why I'm using that language today. But that language is jarring for parents as well. And that's something that I do think we need to think about in terms of as we continue to understand our use of language and how that impacts our children and young people. We see many success stories from children who have been through the tribunal who have experienced exclusion through our inclusion of trying to keep them in a mainstream school. and they've not been attending school, we then see them thriving, performing in school concerts. And we build up a rapport with our clients where they feed back because they've been through such a traumatic time with their child. So we take a lot of pleasure in hearing those success stories. And it's not a tragedy when a child has to be placed in a special provision. It's a tragedy when we're not meeting their needs and trying to fit them to a mould. Mm-hmm. Integration is not enough. Simply saying that a child is in a mainstream and they're physically within the building is not enough. And our children all have the right to achieve their own potential. And I think special schools are extremely key in unlocking that.
Thank you, Chloe. I suppose your comment about each local authority having its own criteria does mean that it's probably not consistently applied. David, can I bring yourself
in?
Yeah, thank you.
I completely agree with a lot of the points that the panel have made, especially around language and just making sure that we're doing the best for individual learners. There's often a very binary discussion around mainstream and specialist schools, and we know that there's lots of different approaches to how mainstream settings operate. Many have ASL hubs, and this can be very effective for children and young people. So I think that kind of broader thinking and a bit of drilling down into how they operate is important. I think there are not always those consistent approaches with how different ASL hubs operate, and we've heard that from our My Rights, My Say service, and that can lead to quite a bit of confusion, I think, with parents and carers. So they're not always sure of the provision that is available within mainstream settings, and that can lead to a kind of an idea that the support isn't available there within mainstream schools, and that certain needs can only be met within specialist settings. And we know that that's not the case, and that's not what's reflected in law. So I do think there needs, again, that kind of communication issue and the information flow with parents and carers is really important.
Do you want to come in again briefly, Marie, before we... Is there anything else?
Yeah, I can. I mean, just echoing what David is saying, we do see that confusion from parents. We mm-hmm. quite often hear that parents have made a placing request, for example, for a mainstream school that has an ASL hub attached to it, because they then feel that that will give their child the chance to sort of do the mainstream but get support from mm-hmm. the ASL provision. But it's not that's not how it works. You know, a placing request would have to be for that ASL provision often. So it's just to say that that's a confusion. We see on top of that you have learning hubs that are not necessarily ASL provisions, and parents sometimes think they can make a placing request for these, but they're sort of readily available for all children.
So a lot of inconsistency and a lot of confusion, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Yes, I have one point just to pick up in terms of that. The way the legislation operates at the moment, it doesn't allow for a parent to apply essentially for a split placement. So if you'd be looking for your child in a mainstream school for half of the time and a special school for another half of the time, the legislation doesn't allow the parent to do that and have the remedy of the tribunal placing request process. You can try and get that through a coordinated support plan, and I think that will probably feed into a conversation later about why coordinated support plans are very important, because they unlock certain remedies that may not be available elsewhere.
Helpful, thank you. Ben McPherson, can we come to yourself now, please? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. On language, Spartans Community Foundation in my constituency call their provision the alternative school, which I think is good. Two brief questions on advocacy. First of all, do you have any comment on how the pandemic has affected demand for advocacy and support for families? It'd be interesting to hear how that's potentially affected the demand. And secondly, I'm curious about the consistency of advocacy across the country. If a parent or a young person in Glasgow needs support, there's the Govan Law Centre, but what about elsewhere? Is that something we need to consider more deeply?
What's important is that our service is a national service, so we can access any parent or young person across Scotland. Sometimes there can be a misconception that if there's a child in the Highlands, you know, we're unable to assist them. That's simply not true, and that has to be really clear messaging. Now, one of the concerns is how do we ensure that we're accessing all of these communities. And again, we do hope that this session with the caseworkers for MSPs will be really helpful in that and ensuring that that information is being disseminated to their constituents.
Just on that, as well as engagement with the MSPs, and you talked about training for local authorities, are there central government agencies that could and should be supporting you more, in your view, to raise awareness?
I think any awareness would be positive awareness. Absolutely. I mean, what specifically that would look like, we have strong relationships, although, to be very clear, we're not in partnership, evidently, with the tribunal, and they will try and direct anyone who comes through the tribunal process who's unrepresented to our service. One thing that I think would be extremely beneficial is when the local authorities send out their refusal letters, some local authorities will include our details as a free service that parents can access. Others don't. There is nothing that requires them to do so. They require to make them aware of their appeal right, but they don't require to make them aware of our free service. So that is a piece that I think needs to be looked at, and is a piece that I raise at tribunal forums and in spaces when local authority are around, and that would certainly be something that I think could have quite a tangible impact. The other issue, and I can't say... I can't say about every local authority, but we have seen far too many local authorities whereby individuals have been sent out a refusal letter and it's not in their first language. Now, the local authority will have that information and they're receiving the letter through in English. And that can mean if someone who speaks Polish receives this letter through, they can inevitably miss their appeal right. So, again, that's something that I think needs to be looked at as a piece and some awareness and support around there.
Thank you.
Just to pick up on your first question, Ben, around the pandemic and that effect that it's had in the demand for advocacy. So, like Govan Law, My Rights, My Say, we provide independent advocacy for children and young people across the country, so across all of Scotland. We also have a Children's Views service that can support professionals to seek out Children's Views specifically. So this is operating nationwide, and I think the main pandemic effect was that the level of complexity in the referrals we see have increased, where before we would maybe see a referral for an autistic child with an ADHD profile. We now see referrals for children that are autistic and have an ADHD profile and who have not attended school for 2 years and who have severe anxiety and are still waiting for support from CAMHS. And they might also be young carers because their parents have suffered over the last couple of years. So the complexity is massive, and it means that our advocacy service is working overtime because we can't just go in and provide advocacy for 6 weeks and then go away, because that's not solving anything. We have a current waiting list for advocacy, which is spanning nearly 6 months now, and that's not... That doesn't fill us with joy. It's not, you know, it's not a good thing that people are wanting your service. In effect, we were talking about it before we came in. In effect, what we are wanting to do is put ourselves out of jobs. We don't want to be needed. But the need for advocacy for children and young people is increasing. And again, My Rights, My Say only operate within the 12 to 15 cohort. But that's not to say that 16-year-olds don't need support. We've done within Children's Views, we have a small pilot project with the ASN Tribunal, because the Tribunal recognises that younger children and children older than 15 really need to share their views for tribunal processes as well. So we have a spot purchase agreement with them that ensures that all children, regardless of their age and capacity, are able to share their views in tribunal processes. And I think that's massively helpful. And the demand for that service, and I think what we're hearing from the tribunal is that it's hugely helpful. I think it gave us a clue as to the need for sort of wider advocacy support for the cohort of children that are not that don't have the rights extended to them in the 2016 amendments to the Education Act. So I think there's something there to unpick, maybe especially with the CRC fully coming in as an act in July, I think we need to think very carefully about how we're going to deliver on not just Article 28 and 29 around the rights and aims of education, but also Article 12, the right to have your views heard, and for those views to be given due weight. I think we're doing what we can. I think the commitment from Scottish Government to My Rights, My Say, and to have this as a function, the same with Govan Law, I think it's admirable, and I think it's really powerful. And I think a lot of countries don't even reach us to the socks. I'm from Denmark, so I speak from experience. but I think there's still a long way to go.
Thank you.
Thanks. I absolutely agree with everything that's been said. We've got colleagues here from two fantastic services that are funded by Scottish Government. They have capacity issues. Marie's just said, you know, they have a six-month waiting list at the moment. There are other ones that are done through services through the voluntary sector. You've heard evidence from Salvos and Mindroom already. They all have capacity issues and they all have gaps. So as Marie says, they're focused on 12 to 15-year-olds. If a child under 12 wants to make a referral to the tribunal, they technically can't. Thankfully, that's not prevented them necessarily, but technically can't. 16 and 17-year-olds who are still children, who according to Scots law, UNCRC, are still children, don't have access to that service because they're treated as young adults, not children, or young people, not children, not given the same rights as other children. So there's gaps. There is not nearly enough advocacy support for parents. There is fantastic organisations doing small amounts of work with limited budgets. But I think there's a real gap. And my biggest concern actually about ASL is the stories we hear and parents who've had the tenaciousness to fight the system, to get to the tribunal and win. Not all parents have that capacity. Looking after a disabled child is hard, hard work. You are battling on every front. If the child has medical conditions, you're also battling there. How many children fall through the gaps because their parents don't have access to advocacy or legal support?
But you agree with everything that's said. I'm glad Megan brought up parents and carers and the challenges that they face. And I think it's making that advocacy and also mediation accessible for parents and carers and supporting them through that process. I think UNCRC provides a really good opportunity to kind of address some of that power imbalance, and I guess under UNCRC but also under GERFEC, the, you know, voices of children, young people and families are central to everything. So we need to be making sure that that's you know, we can make sure advocacy and mediation is accessible so that that's made a reality.
Ben, anything further?
No, thank you. All that.
Okay. Can I come now to Bill Kidd, please? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to everyone, because there's some really good depth of replies here. However, is it possible, in order to provide direction going forward, following the pandemic, and the difficulties that everyone has experienced, and especially children with ASN, has the panel seen good practice with schools and families working together to support re-engagement with learning, so that we're actually getting a symbol for others to work with?
Two questions. Shall I come in here? So, yeah, we've seen lots of great practice, and I think, you know, it's very easy to get into quite a doom and gloom situation. We see some fantastic relationship-based practice happening in schools on a one-to-one level, but also within school communities. So I think that's one of the benefits of the presumption of mainstreaming. It's obviously it's helping to sort of reduce some of the stigma and tackle some of the taboo of disabilities and additional support needs. Children in Scotland, we deliver the Inclusion Ambassadors, and they run and have run a couple of rounds of the Success Looks Different awards, which shows some really positive examples of good practice. So I'd recommend going on the website and having a look at that. But really great relationship base of engaging with children and young people, helping to put the correct supports in place and make sure that they're able to access their best education. I guess there's a lot of that links to kind of culture change across schools and communities, celebrating the success of individual learners and really making sure that we're putting individual supports in place for learners. So yes, some really positive practice, I think, there.
Yeah, I can see that. Thanks very much, David. I can see Megan's looking to...
Yeah, likewise, we've seen a lot of good practice. We've spent quite a lot of time out and about meeting the children and young people in the last few months preparing our new strategic plan. A lot of that involves work done by schools, but a lot of it also involves bringing partners into schools, so working with local third sector organisations, community learning and development, where there's still capacity in that for there. So, and it's around some culture change that's about more flexible approaches. Sometimes gets undermined by, particularly in secondary schools, by the concentration on attainment and senior phase. There's sort of a pivot that happens, which I think has been well rehearsed in this this committee before, so I won't go over it again. But there were schools that genuinely did a lot of work around well-being and coming back, where I think they're seeing the benefits of that now. We were all changed by the pandemic, and we're all changed in ways where none of us yet probably understand, but the impact on children was just so much broader because the pandemic was a much bigger proportion of their lives. The kids that are coming into primary school who are needing more support, they have spent their entire life in pandemic world. Mm. They were babies and toddlers at the beginning, or I think that this year the first ones who were born during the pandemic will start school. So the other thing that I think I've seen some change, you've got had some evidence already from the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapy about the role that they and other allied health professionals can play in some of that kind of catching up after the pandemic, and they're showing they talked about a lot of flexibility in how they work and how that can change to address some of the things that we're seeing coming through from the pandemic from children. So yeah, there's lots of really good practice going on out there. I just wish it was more consistent.
I'm really glad that you asked this question, because I think it's very easy when we're discussing ASL and this whole policy landscape to focus on all the things that are not working. And I think sometimes we need to check ourselves and remind ourselves that actually there is a lot of good practice. There's a lot of commitment. There are a lot of people who are working very, very hard on a day-to-day basis to try to deliver. So some of the things that we've seen that really worked after the pandemic is that extended level of flexibility. A young person told us, if you ask me to do much too quickly, I'm not going to do anything at all. And it's not for lack of wanting, but it's because we sometimes, and I think after the pandemic, there was an expectation that everybody would hop, skip and jump out of bed and run into school and give their teacher an apple. That's not the reality. For a lot of the children we're in contact with, the pandemic provided them with their first opportunity to really engage with learning. You know, to actually feel safe, to actually feel able to hunker down and do their work, because all the stressors, all of the sensory overload, all the potential bullying, all of the conflicts with peers, etc., that was taken away, and all of a sudden they were in their safe space. It's not to say that that's the truth for all ASN learners. We also heard the opposite, you know. So it's not a simple fix. But one of the things that really have worked is that we have seen small pockets of schools trying to work on that hybrid model and trying to sort of ease children and young people back into school rather than asking them on day one to go in full time. I think there's a big overhang of the children who transitioned between primary and secondary during the pandemic. There are, again, this is a quote from a child, he said, I'm part of a lost generation and we need a recovery plan. So this is a young person who said this because everything that they knew, all the structure, all the stability disappeared. And that whole enhanced transition that we know is so crucial for ASN learners, that disappeared. And they were asked to do too much too quickly. And then the result of that was, and I think my rights might say that the average age for children and young people that come to us is around 13 and a half. And that pretty much sort of corresponds to children and young people transitioning into secondary, fighting, trying, doing their best. And then slowly, so what, through S1 and S2, their attendance decreases until eventually it's too hard. And we know that if children stop attending school, it's very, very difficult to get back. So I think the hybrid model and the sort of trying to support children to do what they can and building on that without expecting them to go from 0 to 100, that's really crucial. I'll stop there, otherwise I'll keep on going for another hour.
That's very positive. Chloe, did you want to...
Yes, I think, unfortunately, with my role, by the time someone contacts my office, things aren't great. Okay. I'm under no illusion, though, and when we're at tribunals, we do get the benefit of hearing how the mainstream provision or the school that we're essentially not comparing to, but, you know, hearing evidence on. And we do hear of some very good practice, and I think that is evidenced in the fact that we're seeing a lot of our children with additional support needs able to thrive in their primary school, and it brings us back to the resource issue. We see primary schools being able to put in place more supports because they have less pupils. It's as simple as that. Then we also see the pattern of when children move and transition into their secondary provision, unfortunately attendance starts to decrease until they become school refusers. So I'm not the best for the good side of things, but you know, I am aware that it's there, and you know, we're always cognizant of that as well, that we're dealing with only a certain lens when looking at it.
That's a good positive attitude anyway. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bill Kidd. Now, I'm going to bring Willie Rennie in. He is joining us online. Here we are. Thank you, Willie.
Thanks very much. It's actually just a little bit on that theme that you've just been discussing, what work you've done on the relationship between unmet ASN need, but also absence and the behaviour in schools that we've all been hearing about. What work have you done in that area? I'm particularly anxious about making sure we get it right for every child in the class, and sometimes I feel we're not achieving that in the round, and I just wonder what work you've done in that area.
Marie, do you want to come in first?
Yeah, I can. I'll try to keep it short. I feel like I'm talking a lot. So part of my rights, my say, part of what we're funded to do, Willie, is to support local authorities to develop their commitment to participation and engagement strategies for children and young people. It's a really important and vital part of our service, and it's delivered by Children Scotland. My rights, my say, has four partners. So what we do with that work is we try to work with local authorities to focus on the things that are working, the things that are maybe not working, and the things that can be barriers to good participation practice. And that could be things like relationship building, but also around the language that we use. Again, when we talk about children's behaviour in schools, we often hear quite loaded language being used, and it doesn't come from a bad place. I think it just comes from a place of not always understanding how that affects the children that are being spoken about. So that's one of the things we cover within My Rights, My Say, is trying to avoid using words like challenging, aggressive, etc., because it does leave a mark. So that's part of our next level capacity building efforts. And we also, like I said, try to build on good participation practice. We talk about things like intersecting barriers. We know that inequalities and barriers to learning are cumulative. So I gave an example before of a child being autistic, having ADHD, also potentially being a young carer, looking after a poorly parent. The more barriers you're facing, the further removed you are from your rights. And unfortunately for our services, I think Chloe would agree, the further removed you are from your rights, the less likely we are to get in touch with these families. So it's really important that local authorities understand and know about how intersecting barriers affect children and young people, and in turn that they make sure that they spread the words about our services and that we are here to help.
Could I come back on that, Marie? Yeah. I mean, can you give me some specific examples, without giving names, but can you give me some specific examples of young people that you've seen that things have changed for them and therefore the rest of the class as well?
I need to be careful because I don't want to give specific examples that could lead back to a specific young person. But I know that through our advocacy service, very often what we see, and again, our cohort of children is often children who are in, well, it will usually be secondary school children. And I think especially through our advocacy service, what we can see is that children are finding it hard to access the support they really need. But once they're provided with that opportunity to have advocacy involvement, they're able to share their views with an adult who's not their mum or dad or their carer and who's not someone from education. It's a blank canvas. So advocacy is this wonderful blank canvas where nobody has any expectations and where nobody's taking anyone else's side. So the child gets the opportunity here to just say what
they want, because children very often don't want to upset anyone. They don't want to make anyone sad. They don't want mum and dad to be disappointed, and they don't want the school to think that they're not grateful, etc. But when we get the child on a one-to-one basis and we can sit down and we can find out what works for you, sometimes that involves us being covered in glitter glue or playing Minecraft. We don't really care what it takes to make that child feel comfortable, and we invest a lot of time and energy in getting it right. And once the child gets that chance to share their views in a very, very safe space and realise that those views can be communicated onwards to school in a safe space, and that the school is not just asking but also listening, then we see like a real sense of agency in that child, and we see them almost growing a couple of inches. So I think we need to facilitate that right to share your views. And when we do that, I think we can avoid these very adversarial dispute resolutions that sort of come later. So my aim and my rights, my say's aim is always to try to get in there as early as possible. Like I said, nobody wants a tribunal. It's not a very nice process, as much as the tribunal is doing a wonderful job of making it inclusive. The ideal would be to avoid getting it to that point. So we do see, and we have a lot of real life examples of children who have accessed advocacy, and through advocacy see that their voices and their views matter and are valued by education professionals, by their parents. And I think you need that independent service to provide that, because otherwise there is that risk that the child is not feeling like it's entirely unbiased and impartial. So through the remedy of advocacy, I think we're getting somewhere.
Can I bring in Megan and David on this theme? Thank you.
Megan. Sure. In terms of the links between behaviour and ASN need, and I'd bring in a further topic, and that's the work we did around restraint. We're continuing to do around restraint, indeed. Daniel Johnson's bill has obviously now been coming through Parliament. I think there's undeniably a link if you look at the work that Beth Morrison has done around restraint, and that's a group that perhaps isn't coming through some of the other forums, because that's almost always very young children. I think 8 is about the upper limit of the children, the case studies that she's gathered, and it's often a result of what gets labelled violent behaviour that the child ends up being restrained. That's generally behind the reason why the child is being restrained. So I think there's a really strong link there. You also see the link in terms of the number of children who are excluded, who have additional support needs. Disabled children are disproportionately likely to be excluded. But of the children with additional support needs who are excluded, by far the largest group, and in the most recent year statistics, which I think is 2 years ago now, it was around 4,000, were listed as having their additional support needs social-emotional behavioural difficulties. That label actually really concerns me, because I think given the extent to which those children's behaviour is affecting their school life, they're being excluded. You can't get a much bigger impact on your school life than not being allowed to go to school. That there is probably an unrecognised other additional support need category in there that somehow hasn't been identified. So I think there's an issue around not recognising specifics about additional support needs. And I think without recognising that there's an additional support need, that it's additional support need because they have an autistic spectrum disorder or some other condition. The diagnosis, though you don't need a diagnosis to be given the support, diagnoses are useful because they tell professionals what kind of support is needed. Access to diagnosis, as we know, is a big issue. So I think there's a big link between all of those things, particularly around very young children, particularly around restraint.
David Mackay and then Chloe Minto, please.
Thank you. I'll keep it fairly brief. So your question, Willie, was around unmet need in schools. And I think just want to highlight the value of people support staff in terms of helping to identify some of the needs, individual needs of children and young people in schools. And we've done lots of work with the inclusion ambassadors about what good people support staff looks like. We've also involved in the kind of Scottish Government's people support staff advisory group, and I know there's lots of work going on around that, around learning frameworks, and I think that's a big discussion which the committee has touched on in the past that we'd like to come back to. But we know the individual support within schools is kind of crucial to achieving the best outcomes and also identifying needs within the classroom. we've seen since the pandemic, I think a lack in that one-to-one support that is available within the classrooms. And so I think if you're withdrawing that, or there are challenges to delivering that, then that's going to result in more young people slipping under the net. In terms of the behaviour and violence in schools, so we've been involved in the summits, Children in Scotland, but I think you know, it's really important, as Megan talked around, reframing the discussion on that and looking at that kind of you know, bad behaviour to distressed behaviour, shifting the dial, I guess. And the inclusion ambassadors are also going to, they identified this as an issue back early, towards the end of last year, and they're going to be doing a bit of focused work around behaviour and violence in schools, which we'll be happy to share with the committee in the coming months.
Excellent, thank you. Chloe.
Thank you. In terms of how we remedy some of those unmet needs that we see, we do have a strategic litigation aspect of our service. So what we do is we look at the data that we gather, we look at the trends that we're seeing, whether that be in terms of an area, so it may be a local authority, or it may be a particular issue that we're seeing. One that we're seeing at the moment is exclusions, as we've heard. We're seeing many more, both formal, but more concerningly, informal exclusions, so unlawful exclusions. Our inquiries have almost doubled since 2018 in terms of what we're hearing from people about exclusions. So what we can do is we can then decide, okay, well, when we're gathering information from parents, let's make sure that's a question that we ask them. Have they ever been asked to go and cool off? That's an unlawful exclusion. And we can start gathering that data and working out, okay, what is the best way that we can get this into a space where we're going to make some systemic change by raising litigation in that area. So I think that's where it's really important. And in terms of our inquiry helpline, that even if a parent is not thinking about going forward with the tribunal, that we have that discussion, and that allows us to see how things are happening around Scotland and take action if necessary.
Thank you. In the interest of time, Mr Rennie, I do need to move on to our next line of questioning from Ruth Maguire, please. We are hoping to conclude this session at 10:30, so if you, just as a reminder for everyone in the room. Thank you, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I had questions around avoiding relationships becoming adversarial. I actually think we've probably covered the things that can be done in terms of communication and also the important point about masking. So I wonder if I could ask Chloe Minto about something that you mentioned, the number of files that Govan Law Centre had dealt with, and that there were only 8 for care experienced children. It would be lovely to think that that's because their needs are being met. I suspect there might be other challenges around that. Is that to do with... obviously, we spoke about capacity in terms of challenging local authorities. I suppose if you're a local authority employee caring for a young person, it might be hard to challenge your employer. Do you know why?
I think the honest answer is I don't know. I can only speculate, and I don't want to speculate. Sure. What we know is that we want to find out why, and that's a big piece of what we're wanting to focus on right now, is how do we access these children? It may be that their needs are being met. We doubt that it is, but we're sure that there will be some whose needs are being met. But I think that comes back to some of the responses that we've seen, that I was actually extremely disappointed to see some of the comments from local authorities about when our service becomes involved, and that can bring, I think one of the words used was either confrontation or controversial approach. I found that very disappointing to read. What parents are accessing as a legal remedy. Parents don't want to go to tribunal. We don't want them to have to go to tribunal. We make every effort that we can to negotiate and resolve cases. And I think one of the important things is that we are telling our clients to trust in the local authorities. Let's have discussions. Let's see what we can do. And we try and be very clear that that is our messaging. So to see comments saying that there is a bias within the tribunal system as well, which I think is a grossly unfounded comment to make, extremely disappointing to see, and I can categorically say it's not the case. Mm-hmm. We have lost many cases, you know, if that makes things any better. We don't work in partnership with the tribunal, and it's a fact. Based, each case is considered of its own merits. So I do think there's a piece around perhaps how our service is perceived that I'm trying very hard to work on and build upon in terms of whether local authorities feel they can contact us. Our inquiry line is available for local authority employees who can phone on a confidential basis to discuss matters. Unfortunately, one of the first things that will be said on our inquiry line when a local authority employee phones is, I'm really worried about my employer's known I'm having this call. Okay. That's really disappointing. We immediately go into a kind of how do we protect them space. They're worried about phoning about a child who's got additional needs and voicing those concerns. Again, when it comes to witnesses coming to a tribunal, we see a hesitation when individuals work at a local authority to come forward. I have to say that's starting to get better, and that's through us again speaking with local authorities and trying to make sure that their employees feel comfortable going, because otherwise we will just cite them, and we don't want to do that. We would rather that there was that engagement.
Okay. I think the independence of the tribunal service came across quite well in evidence last week. Did Government Law Centre know the demographics of the parents who are making it to you, if you like? I suppose I'd be curious about who's being missed out, who's not making it to your services.
Yes, so we have a very extensive monitoring process in terms of who's accessing our service that we report to our funders every quarter, our funders being Scottish Government, every quarter. So I think in terms of, I did see some comments about who is accessing the tribunal, and when we were reflecting, or I was reflecting on the statistics for today, I was actually quite surprised and pleasantly surprised to see that the majority of our cases are in quintile 1 and quintile 2. That's the majority of parents who are accessing our service. So when we're looking at SIMD, it's very good to see that we are accessing them. But I do have a lot of information in terms of what we gather that I could provide to the committee in writing if that were to be of assistance.
That would be very helpful.
Megan and David, I think, might want to come in on these questions briefly.
Yeah, I just want to echo the concern that it was expressed in a submission to this committee that there may be some bias at the tribunal. I think that's a really, really concerning statement to have got into the papers that suggests it might actually be out there more widely and perhaps we don't know about it. In terms of looked after children, I suspect we're going to get a question about CSPs at some point.
Yes, but yes, I want to. Right, I assure you, so if you don't mind, moving on to.
In terms of looked after children specifically, though, just in case the point gets asked, they are already receiving support from the education authority and the local authority in another guise. So the likelihood that they're eligible for a CSP is already higher, and yet we don't see that come through. I think it's really concerning. Effectively, they're in the position of challenging the people who also look after their living, day-to-day living, around their education. Yeah. Their corporate parent is the person they're challenging. So it's really concerning how low the numbers actually are. We would expect to see them to be higher.
You're okay? All right. Thank you, David. He's okay. Yes, I think that was the point of that conflict between corporate parent and employer, was where Ruth McGuire was questioning around. Can I now move to Stephanie Callaghan, please. Thank you for your patience, Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener, and really helpful to have heard from you already. I'm wondering as well, local authorities, there's been a bit of talk about, you know, when the job's been done well, when they're actually putting wellbeing at the centre and they're listening and responding to the views of young people, their parents and carers and children. So I'm wondering, are there some good examples of where this has been done well? probably in the early stages, if you like. And are there key things in common there as well?
That link goes Who'd up? Like to come in first on that one? Are you okay?
Same answer for me. I don't think I'm best placed
okay,
to
comment
on
fine.
This.
Okay, that's fine. Lovely. David?
We have seen lots of positive examples all across Scotland, and as I said, the success looks different. Awards have done that, and I guess a key part of it is those relationships and communicate. We were talking about the positive relationships, so it's celebrating that success. It's that regular communication with home, and making sure that, I think we've spoken to parents who said, you know, when you have a child with additional support needs, you can feel constantly ground down by it, and it's really about celebrating the individual's success and making sure that that's communicated. I think we could certainly provide details of individual schools that we can share as part of the Success Looks Different awards who are you know, having those positive relationships with parents, mm-hmm. carers. So happy to provide some information in writing following this. Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
And I wanted to ask specifically about autism. So the tribunal applications, we know, have been rapidly rising, and 134 out of 202 cases, which is over 66%, related to autistic young people and children. So we've already heard some mention of masking and of sensory issues, of anxiety as well. I'm wondering, are there particular challenges then around autistic children that really there need to be strategies and supports in place for that particular group who seem to be very, very often coming to those tribunals? Because obviously part-time timetabling isn't really the big solution for it.
Marie first. And, yeah.
Just to make a really brief point on that, because we've touched slightly on it before, but I think one of the main challenges for autistic children in our schools are that the schools are not set up for autistic children and young people. So we want children to have the opportunity to mainstream. We want them to be able to have an inclusive education where they can connect with their peers, and where we all work towards this diverse society where we realise that everybody has a potential. And I think that's a wonderful idea on paper, but I think there are physical problems with that, and that comes down to the space of the schools. Megan touched on that earlier as well, with this very open plan, but it's down to details like busy walls, the lighting, the noise that comes from the lighting, the busy corridors, the sort of mapping of a school, the fact that you come from primary school where there's an ability to support and to create safe small workspaces for children and young people, and you come without particularly big fanfare into a secondary environment where you are having to navigate, again, the school is not wrapping itself around you, you have to wrap yourself around the school. And I think that is a massive challenge for autistic young people to make that transition for primary, even with enhanced transition, with visits, the physical layout of the schools is quite complicated. In Scandinavia, you don't start secondary school until you're 15 or 16. So for me, I was quite surprised when I came to Scotland and realised that you're having to make that massive transition at an earlier age. And I don't know if there's learning to be harnessed there. I think the main point is that it's stressful for any child to transition from primary to secondary school. If you're autistic, then add 1,000.
So I suppose just picking up on that as well then, you talked about those safe small spaces, mm-hmm. that you get in primary schools. Are there things that we could possibly be doing with our secondary estate as it is just now to actually create those kind of spaces and really improve things for people? I can see Megan wants to come in that one.
We did some work about 20 years ago. It's very, very, very out of date now. Probably needs revisiting, possibly not by us, but around how we're building schools, and I think that's something that would really be valuable to look at, because there is this big jolt that comes at the transition to secondary school for a lot of autistic children. And the other thing is that I think people talk about how there are many more autistic children, and I think actually we're realising there are many more autistic children. I'm very aware of a trend where of parents being diagnosed as autistic after their children are diagnosed,
yes.
Particularly girls, so particularly women being diagnosed in adulthood. It's not something new, but we're getting better at recognising it. That's good, but now we need to respond to it. I mentioned earlier, 37% of children having additional support needs, and I'm going to separate out the concept of disability from additional support needs a bit. They may still have a disability, but actually if schools meet their needs better, they no longer have additional support needs because they're getting the support automatically. And that's some of the things that have been lost, like use of classroom support systems, which can even create that breakaway in the same space with how we lay out our schools, how we build new schools. There are a lot of schools out there that were built under, secondary schools that are built under there that aren't dissimilar to prisons, apart from lack of bars on the doors. They're very hard, noisy, loud spaces with very bright lighting, and that can be quite hostile. I'm not from Denmark, but I actually went to high school there for a bit, so I agree. There's definitely also other things. I think there's maybe a much, much bigger discussion on education that this transition from primary to secondary school at 11 or 12 is quite a hard jolt for a lot of children. And it shows through the casework that's been talked about today. So I think there's a lot more to look at there, and one of the ways to do it is to talk to autistic children themselves and the ones who aren't in school, as well as the ones who are in school, about what is and isn't working for them.
Thank you. Can we move now to Ross Greer? Thank you very much.
Thanks, Convener. At various points, everybody on the panel has been very keen to talk about coordinated support plans, which you'll be delighted to know we can now do. In the first instance, Chloe, you mentioned just how important they are because they open up that route for legal redress through the tribunal. So I suppose my first question would be, given that they're like hen's teeth, it's like 0.2% of all pupils with a recognised additional need have a coordinated support plan, is it an issue that there are no other routes to access a tribunal? You can either fight really hard to get a CSP. The vast, vast, vast majority of children with additional support needs won't get one, though. Or you can go for the somewhat nuclear option of trying to get a placing request and move out of a mainstream school into a special school. Is there an issue that CSPs are the only route to access the tribunal while staying in a mainstream setting?
Yes, they are, unless we're looking at a disability discrimination claim, which would be under a different heading, and there are different routes there in terms of coordinated support plans that you can go down through the disability discrimination route. But in terms of coordinated support plan cases, again, I think it's helpful if you hear our figures just to get a real picture of what this looks like. And in the past 5.5 years, we have only had 58 cases going to the tribunal from our service in relation to coordinated support plans. Now, that's inclusive of failure to implement. It may be the content of the coordinated support plan. But we are constantly in a state of, where are the coordinated support plans? What on earth is going on? And they do provide really rich remedies there. They provide really rich conversations. They engage parents. They engage children. And I think the thing that we need to remember is they're not discretionary. They must be in place. If you qualify, they must be in place. And there still seems to be a discourse that they have a child's plan. We hear it far too often. We use an individualised education plan, or we use a slightly different plan. And we do feel very fatigued with that because we're not really sure how much clearer everyone can make it. The president of the tribunal has come out and made that clear, it's very clear in our legislation. We're making it clear. So I'm not sure, again, what local authorities are in understanding about that. So if your child qualifies, they must have one. Again, we offer training on that. So we would hope that if there were any confusion around that legislation, then we would be hearing more inquiries. What concerns us is we don't hear from anyone saying we don't understand the legislation.
I can see Megan looking to come out. I just want to follow up that point, though, because the cynical answer for local authorities not understanding that is that they do, and they just do not want to implement CSPs. Child's plans in general are going to be less resource intensive, or at the very least, mean that the local authority is somewhat shielded from the potential legal redress through the tribunal system. Do you think that the cynical explanation is perhaps a fair one, given the amount of information over such a long period of time that's been provided?
I think we need to be realistic in terms of when we hear information from parents about what's happening on the ground and about the perception of coordinated support plans. What they do is bind local authorities to doing certain things. So not only are we looking at a lack of coordinated support plans, but we're also then looking at, once we do get a coordinated support plan, them being so broad that, you know, they're barely providing any enforceable educational objectives. So in terms of the content of the coordinated support plan, that is so important to make sure that it's achieving the goal and the reason that that is the only statutory plan that is in place. I've heard of a special school where it was very clear that there were a lot of children who qualified for a coordinated support plan, and the information came to light that there were none that had a coordinated support plan. In that instance, I do feel that it was a genuine misunderstanding, but these misunderstandings have fatal consequences for the children who are entitled to this support.
So children have a right to an effective remedy. That's not in the UNCRC, it's in the European Convention on Human Rights. It's been incorporated for 16 years, I can't count today, 26 years in fact. The ASL Act is giving a very good right to remedy to a very small group of children via the tribunal. I think in terms of the coordinated support plans, I think the legislation is I think it is being interpreted extremely narrowly. There is an interpretation of that legislation that would entitle far more children to to coordinated support plans. And coordinated support plans are important because they're the only one where there is that right to remedy to go to the tribunal. In the absence of a different statutory plan, and we could have a second statutory plan system that had a proper appeal process in the way that CSPs do. We don't. We have IEPs and we have child's plans and we have My World plans and we have other things in different local authorities. But none of them are actually delivering an effective right to remedy. We've heard from SPSO that they're not reaching SPSO as complaints, because SPSO think that probably belongs in the tribunal, and it probably does. They're right. But they're not getting that right to remedy. That's why CSPs are important. We've had the same experience as Chloe. In our case, it was a residential special school, and I think there may have been one CSP. There's children from a number of local authorities in a residential school. Local authorities were paying very large sums of money, and these children were in those schools, all residential as well as education. We can't imagine a scenario in which those children don't qualify for a CSP, and yet none of them had it, or perhaps one. So we've come across that as well. They are in an entitlement. They're not happening. I can't even comment on quality of them. We see them so rarely. I know that, you know, when in the past we've had advice calls around it, it's been the first question, is there a CSP? It's always no.
Does your office have a position on the solution then? Because we're all now incredibly, weirdly familiar with just how hard it is to get one, how few young people have them, and the issues about getting one that's still not making a difference. But I'd be interested, does your office have a position on the need for the legislation to change, or is it an implementation issue, or both, or...
I think our position is probably evolving, because actually when we've looked at this, it's worse than we thought.
Yeah.
And every time we look at it, it's worse than we think. But there needs to be some form of right to remedy. If a child is not getting their additional support they're entitled to, whether or not they meet the criteria for the CSP, in whatever way it's interpreted, there's code of practice is being reviewed, there's an opportunity for that guidance to make clear how it should be interpreted, and it could broaden it. But whether or not they meet the criteria for a CSP, there has to be an avenue through which that right to remedy can be accessed by children and their families, and it's not there. They potentially could go through the local authority complaints process. What SPSO tell us is that they're not getting as far as SPSO. They also need to know they have that right, and I think a lot of people, you know, what is a CSP is something you hear. You know, they don't know they've got, even if they're entitled to one, they don't know they have a right to one, and they don't know they have a right to remedy that attaches to it. So there's this massive hole
Thank
in terms
you,
of access to right to remedy.
Thanks. Did I see Marie looking to...
She's OK. Megan's just made her point, so I think she's reinforcing that list. But yeah. David?
Completely agree as well. Don't want to waste more time, but clarity and accountability for families and children and young people. Yeah, and making sure that there's a consistency around parents and carers being equal partners in that right. Yep.
And can I just briefly check in? Just hopefully, as very brief, Megan, on the point around the revision to the code of practice, could you foresee a scenario where that kind of that would address this issue sufficiently and mean that we wouldn't actually need a legislative change, or is something more than changing the, or revising, improving the code of practice required here?
There needs to be something that also addresses a right to remedy for children who don't meet those criteria, and there will be children out there who don't. There are also just recognise that children move in and out of being eligible for a CSP over the course of their life, so they might have considerable involvement from health for a period of time, which puts them into that category of one or more appropriate agencies, or they might have input from a third sector organisation. That would also meet that criteria. I'm not sure it's being interpreted like that. I mean, in fact, we're sure it's not being interpreted like that, because otherwise we would see more of them. Yeah. But, yeah, children can move in and out of that eligibility as well. So there's a real, real gap in right to remedy. This is one of the issues that comes to us most often.
And I know if I come to Liam Kerr for the final sort of theme, he'll be picking up more on this as well.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I have two questions which I'll direct very specifically. Chloe Minto, what is the availability of legal aid and specialist solicitors in this area? Because last week we heard that the cost of representation at things like a tribunal is often prohibitive. And there was a suggestion that it can sometimes be a challenge to find skilled legal representation specifically in this area.
Well, we are very fortunate that we're in the position that we have funding in place. So just to understand our service, we don't have a waiting list and we are unable to turn away any client. So anyone that has that right, we will take on. So there is no restriction there in terms of who would be able to access our service. If for whatever reason we can't, if there's a conflict of interest, then we would refer to another solicitor and make our funders aware, and then they contact them directly. So the only things that we would really need to be looking at legal aid for would be in terms of any outlays. So that would be us instructing independent reports. Now, in the entire time, in the entire 2.5 years that I've been at Govan Law Centre, that's never something I've had to do. So it's not something, and I think that comes down to the fact that the setup of the Additional Support Needs Tribunal and having those specialist members on the panel really does that rich evidential value and that understanding in terms of when we're asking questions. The other area that we would look at would be for translation costs. So if we needed to get interpreters involved. So I don't see there being a restriction in terms of funds, but that's only to our service. Unfortunately, I can't comment on availability otherwise, because it's simply not something that we require to utilise in order to have people use our service.
Just before I bring in Megan Farr on the same point, and I will be coming to you my second question anyway, can you explain to me, Chloe, just something that I'm struggling with from an answer you gave earlier, because you said the Govan Law Centre would cover the whole of Scotland, but is presumably based in Govan.
Yes.
So how does someone in my area, in Aberdeen, who needs that representation or needs that support, how do they know and how do they access your support if they need it?
I suppose that comes back to what I was saying about if the local authorities put it in the letter, that would make things a lot easier for us. Again, our information is on the tribunal's website as the national agency, and we do have things like a Facebook page that we try and get information out. We offer out to as many training events as possible, so we'll try and link in with people like My Rights, My Say, and ensure that we're attending as many parent groups. If we get invited to them, then we will always go. We're very keen to get in the space and make sure people know about us. And we know that people from Aberdeen know about us because we do have a breadth of cases across Scotland. It tends to be parents that spread the word. It really tends to be once we have one parent of a child or young person with additional support needs, you tend to find that there are then kind of parent groups, and then our name will get landed in one of those parent groups, and then we'll see a sudden flurry of people contacting us from the Highlands because it's made it into the parent group there. But the service would be the exact same, and we would adapt our service to whatever worked for that person. The fortunate position that we're in right now is that by virtue of the pandemic, our working life has changed. Video calls are so accessible now. They tend to work very well for our clients, particularly when they have a child with additional support needs. It could be very challenging to get to and from the office, and tribunals are also available online as well.
Very grateful. Megan Farr, you might have something to add to that. I'll ask you a direct question on your submission. Or the Commissioner's submission mentions the independent adjudication process, and I'm not convinced that's particularly well used. At the risk of asking a leading setup, I think if one wants to avail oneself of that process, you have to apply to the Scottish ministers. Given all of that, why do you think that independent adjudication is not better used, and how might you change it such that it is?
I think none of these processes are well used, and it's probably as much as anything an awareness issue. I'll have to have an admission that you've managed to ask me about the one bit of our response I didn't write. But I think that's a consistent problem across all of the systems, and I'm pretty confident it's the same of that. It's simply just not aware of it. And there is something about a duty that local authorities have to let people know, and it's not a legal duty, it's not currently, but actually I think it's a moral duty of letting children and their parents and carers know of the various rights to remedy that are available to them. It doesn't help that they're complex, and it doesn't help that sometimes the information they receive about them isn't always accurate. I think we've had examples, and not specifically about the independent adjudication service, but about other ones where parents have been told, oh no, you can't go to a tribunal, for example, because actually that placing request you made wasn't really a placing request. So I think there's also some confusion possibly out there around professionals even about what the options are and how they're available. I can see Marie can come in, and hopefully will save me slightly.
I can come in ever so slightly, but again, from the children's perspective, because it is one of the rights. Children can request independent adjudication as well, and we see it very underutilised. There are several reasons for that. One is it's quite a complex it feels like quite a legal process for children and young people. It doesn't feel like something that's particularly easy to do. And there's also the fact that it sort of has to traverse through local authority, and there is an opportunity for the local authority to almost veto that process. And for children and young people with additional support needs to put in the effort to speak to a solicitor, to speak to an advocacy worker, to put themselves out there in a big way, only for that process to then be halted for them is painful. And it makes us, I mean, we have barely seen any through My Rights, My Say. It's quite a rare occurrence that they come our way. But when we do, We haven't, the whole process, I don't think we have seen the whole process through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I could come back in on the question on legal aid, which was, you asked earlier. We do have a really long standing, I think as long as the office has been in existing, we've had this position around children's right to access legal aid independently. So children can be assessed based on their parents' income. I think it's really important that children who want to exercise their rights are able to do so, and that's not a barrier. So, and I'm just repeating our call that actually that, and that goes across all areas. It's not just a relation to education law. We're in a better position than others.
Thank you very much. And as you see, we always have this canter towards the end of the session where the convener gets a little bit twitchy at the top. So thank you very much. And I'd like to thank you for your... unless it's very brief, David, because we are way over.
Digital inclusion as well, and the sort of equipment, internet access and skills that parents and carers have to access some of these remedies.
Sorry. Thank you very much for putting that point, and we'll look into that again. Can I thank everybody for their evidence this morning, and I now suspend the meeting for 15 minutes to allow our witnesses to leave and for our second panel to come in. Thank you very much. Welcome back, and can I welcome our second panel to the committee this morning. We have Dr. Lynn Burney, Chair of the ASN Network, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, who will probably abbreviate to ADES throughout the meeting for those tuning in. Anthony Clark, Executive Director of Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland. Nicola Dickey, Director of People Policy at COSLA. Kerry Drinan, thank you. Education Service Manager, Additional Support Needs Inclusion at Falkirk Council. And Vivian Sutherland, the Principal Psychologist and Educational Psychology Service from Fife Council. So welcome and thank you for giving up your time this morning and coming along and for your written submissions that you provided us ahead of the meeting. It's been very helpful. We will move directly to questions from members and can I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for what you've submitted in advance, as the Convener says. I just have a fairly open question to start with, and that is, why do parents feel they have to fight all the time? What do you think the root cause of the difficulties they and children and young people are facing are?
Who'd like to go first on that big opener for 10? Vivian?
Making a start on that one. That's a big question. And I know that was a theme that came through in the Morgan Review, that families talked a lot about having to fight and to battle and to so on and so on. My experience as working as a local authority educational psychologist and now principal educational psychologist is that we work really hard to prevent families having to feel that they battle, but a small number definitely do feel that that's the case. I think schools and services in schools do a really good job of trying to intervene early with the vast majority of families who have concerns about how their children's needs are being met. And those do tend to be resolved at a relatively low level. Our principle is always to try and resolve issues at the lowest level of intervention possible. And now there are a number of staged approaches which would involve educational psychologists often being brought in to help mediate where there are disagreements about needs. Education managers often get involved in that as well. And I do think that we're all disappointed and concerned when something progresses to the point where families feel that it can no longer be resolved by the local authority and we end up having to be engaged in the tribunal system, for example. But in my experience, I don't feel that all families do need to battle, and I think that we need to listen really carefully to the ones who do feel they have that experience to see what could we have learned and what could we have done at an earlier stage that would have made them feel differently about that. And I know that a lot of families would talk about resourcing and needing to have more staff in schools and so on. But sometimes, if we can work really well and sympathetically with families, we can actually dig up that there's other things that we can do to ensure that their children have a good experience of school where they like to attend, they go in every day, they have a satisfying experience, they do make progress. And to be honest, that's what we find most families really, really want. So that we tend to try and set a shared goal with families so that we can achieve that. We're not always successful and we try to learn from that. But I would say that in the vast majority of cases, we resolve things so that they never get to that crisis point. Others will have an additional view, I'm sure.
Dr. Binney.
Thank you. I would share Vivian's view on that, in that ADES and our work with our local authority representatives would always be around meeting parents where they are, listening to their concerns and resolving their concerns as early as we possibly can. And given there are 37% of children with additional support needs in our schools, I think we local authorities are relatively very successful around doing that, and our head teachers and student leaders in our school take the responsibility first and foremost to discuss concerns with parents and put in place adjustments and remedies at the school level to try and resolve any concerns that they may have. Of course, a small number of parents and carers do not feel that their concerns are listened to, and local authorities have in place a number of staged interventions that parents can access to have their concerns raised. I think in my experience, when listening to some of the complaints or some of the tribunal cases that come in over my desk day to day, often what is at the heart of the issue is a breakdown in communication, a breakdown in relationships. And I think that was very much came through the Morgan Review. And I think there are things that local authorities could do better and are trying to do better to ensure that our communication with parents and carers are written in a language that they understand, that they understand their rights, that they understand the remedies that are available to them, but first and foremost that we put relationships at the heart of all of that work. And I think, as Vivian said, listening to when we're not getting it right and having a learning approach to those cases is really important at a local authority level and indeed at an ADES level. And I think there are a number of examples I could give you as to how local authorities are trying to take aspects of that Morgan Review forward.
Anyone else want to come in? Nicola?
Yeah, thanks very much. And I suppose just to add to what colleagues have already said there, I mean, local government on large is committed to the mainstreaming agenda that's been in play for over 20 years. I think as Vivian's just said there, 37% of children, more than that in some areas, have additional support needs. That means that the mainstream offer for many children has been augmented and added to make sure that we are meeting their individual support needs. So I think there is something about the communication around about how additional support needs are met within the mainstream. I also think that there's no doubt that budgets are challenging for local government. Education has been prioritised, and there's a different committee coming and going into that, I'm sure. But that doesn't mean that all of the other wraparound services that support our children and young people to live the best lives possible haven't been under sustained pressure, and I suspect that's some of the stuff that we might come on to talk about. The other thing I would say is around about that communication point. Complaints and tribunals across all of the public sector should always be resolved at the lowest possible level. We shouldn't need to get to the point where we've got tribunals that are very adversarial, and I'm sure that's what Angela Morgan heard when she spoke to people. So I think we do need to make sure that the messaging coming out of the system makes it clear that mainstream education is the best place for as many children as we possibly can. I think we've got to recognise that it'll take more than schools to make sure that children and young people fulfil their full potential and enjoy their time in our education system. And I suppose lastly, we do need to think about what is the sweet spot around about the funding that is available for schools and education support.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And actually, that brings me nicely on to my next question, which is, do you believe that local authorities are taking a rights-based approach? And how is that reflected then in resource allocations for pupils with complex needs and also supporting families and young people to contribute to and challenge decisions of the local authority?
Local authorities are incredibly aware of the need to balance the rights of all of our children and young people within our schools. I think one of the issues with mainstreaming of additional support needs and the length of time that it's been like that is it's incredibly difficult to track through a local government budget exactly what proportion of spend is going to children who've got additional support needs. I don't think that's the right thing, because it's part of the mainstream and we have integrated all of the support, but I do think it is difficult to track that. I think the other point is around about the rights-based approach is that it takes time, it takes training, it takes understanding to make that happen. So I do think there's more that we can be doing in that, but I do think we recognise it. I don't think we always get it right, but I do think we need to spend more time thinking about how we build that rights-based approach in. But I'm sure colleagues will be aware of what goes on in individual schools, etc.
Kerry, do you want to come in on this?
There is a lot of training going on. There's a lot of understanding. I think in Falkirk, we've got a lot of what we call rights-respecting schools, and it's to ensure that our young people are having their voice heard very actively, that they're being involved in key planning decisions, that kind of filters all the way down to the planning and assessment for meeting children's wellbeing. If we think about the team around the child, we work really hard to make sure that the young person has the voice in the decisions that are happening around and about them, and it starts right from that planning and assessment, that they can talk about their wellbeing needs, they can comment on the plan, if it's going to meet their needs and if it's things that will help them. So from that rights-based point of view, it's about putting the child at the centre of all that planning and assessment. And our schools are very good at doing that and very clear about doing that. But there is still, now that it's enshrined in law, there's probably going to be a need for more training and making sure that all of our young people's rights are being protected and our young people are empowered to use them. So, for example, we have a lot of work with the My Rights, My Say organisation, and we promote that amongst our staff so that our staff can promote it with our young people. We don't have a lot of young people using it, but the ones that have found it really useful in getting their voice on the table and being able to ask for the support that they think they want and that would benefit them most. So while there's probably still a long way to go, I think we've got really strong foundations in place to protect and promote our young people's rights.
Thank you, Kerry. Anthony?
I'm not in a position to comment on the operational practices within local authorities or education authorities, but you asked a question around human rights-based budgeting and the allocation of resources. I think the evidence that we see is that local authorities are adopting a range of different approaches to engage with communities to understand what the impact of the difficult choices they're making might be on different community groups, and in some cases, people with protected characteristics. But it seems to us there's still more to do to develop this practice, and as the UNCRC comes into law, I think that will pose a particular new set of challenges for local authorities and indeed the Scottish Government. This seems to be an emerging area of practice in terms of budgeting and budget allocation, both at a strategic level and also how resources are deployed within individual local authorities or other public bodies. It feels like a complex area.
That segues lovely on to the next theme of questioning from Ben McPherson, please.
Thanks very much, Anthony Clark. You've teed that up perfectly for my next question to yourself, please. But happy to hear from others, of course, thereafter. We're interested in the challenges for the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland to understand spend on pupils with additional support needs and the outcomes for those people.
Thank you for the question. This is indeed a difficult area. I mean, I think in the budget papers, in the papers you've seen at the committee, there's some attribution of spend to additional support needs. It seems to us that that doesn't really catch what's going on. It's relatively straightforward to identify expenditure on special schools, whether we use that term and accept that term, that's what many people call them, and central support teams. What I think is very difficult to account for and understand is the contribution that many other staff that are working with children with complex needs, what the cost of that support is. Also, I think it's important to recognise that this isn't just a local authority question. You know, health, the third sector, housing and other partners have an important part to play here. We think it would be really important to try and understand what those contributions are, but the way in which budgets are allocated and accounted for doesn't allow that to happen. So there's a real challenge here, I think, in understanding how complex services that involve different partners, what resources are being deployed in those areas, Mr. McPherson. Yeah.
Thank you. And just a supplementary to that, given the Accounts Commission generally produces its analysis on a local authority by local authority basis, and trying to get a holistic view across the country for yourselves, but also I imagine for COSLA is quite a challenge.
It's a challenge. You'll know that we are currently thinking about doing a specific piece of performance audit work in this area, and obviously we want to wait and see what comes out of the inquiry to help us think about the scope and shape of that work. If we do decide to do performance audit work to follow up on the issues you identify in your inquiry, the level of funding allocation, how funding is deployed, will be an important part of that work. And whilst I said to you earlier, Mr. McPherson, it's difficult, it doesn't mean it's impossible. Mm-hmm. So we would want to, when conducting any piece of performance audit work, to try and understand the allocation of resources, not just by local authorities, but the contribution that partners are making as well.
Yeah, third sector in particular.
Can I bring sure. Bill in before you move on to your next? Is that okay?
Yeah, sure. I think Nicola Dickey also wanted to answer.
I think, it'll make sense. All right. Bill Kidd, please.
Thank you very much, convener. I'll try and make sense. So, in terms of spend per pupil, as we've been told, in mainstream settings is actually increasing, how does this square with the common perception, and I think it's been covered a wee bit already, that resources for children with complex needs are actually diminishing? That's the perception that many people have. Do you know how you can square those two together, please?
Nicola?
So I think it goes back to what I touched on my first answer. I think, first of all, it's the communication of that. I think the fact that you can't actually take the budget and carve it up and say X amount went for additional support needs is because so much of it is hard-coded across the mainstream provision. Yeah. We think about initial teacher training. We do modules in there where initial teacher training covers that, but we don't then split a teacher's time up when they're actually in the class working with people to say you spend X amount of your time and therefore that amount of the pound goes against that. So I think there's the communication issue around about exactly what's going on there. I think, as Mr McPherson's question touched on there, the further out from the child you start to zoom that lens, the more and more complex it comes to what's wrapped around that child. So that's from teaching resource that's available, to the support staff that are available, to the housing staff, to the local authority staff, out to the third sector, out to the health service. So I think it's something that we've always struggled with as we've integrated services, not just in this field but others, about actually tracking that pound. So what I would say is that it is an issue. It's something that I think I agree with Anthony. It's not impossible, but it will take thinking a bit outside the box. And some of it, I'm afraid, is not going to be hard facts and figures. It's going to be how does this feel in a classroom? How does this look when you're doing some of that? And I suspect that's where our auditors would be coming at us and saying, well, that's all very good and well, but... So I think it is an issue. It's something that we are aware of, but it can be done. And if we crack it for this, I suspect there'll be other parts of the public sector coming and asking us what we did.
Well, bring yourself back in, Anthony, before we come to other panels, members.
I think my point would be we need to make some assumptions around budget spend and resource allocation, and there will be a high degree of uncertainty around that, but it doesn't mean we shouldn't try to do it. And as Nicholas said, this could be an important test case of understanding how resources are deployed to deliver complex outcomes, which might be useful learning for the Scottish Parliament, for local government and other public bodies as well.
Dr. Binney?
I think for me, we have to take into account that within Scotland, our additional support needs legislation and definition is very broad. It takes in a large number of our young people, 37% of our children and young people in schools. In my own local authority, we have 51% in Edinburgh of children and young people with additional support needs in our secondary sector. That's just tipping over half of all of the children. The range of needs can, and the children can dip in and out of additional support needs depending on their particular family living conditions at a particular time or health condition at a particular time. We work across the range of children who have dyslexia, that is difficulty with reading and spelling, to the more complex needs that need full-time medical care, and distinguishing aspects of the roles and supports we have in our school system to meet those needs, I think will be very difficult. We have a very progressive, inclusive approach in Scotland that essentially makes every part of the workforce that works in education and works with education have inclusion at the heart and equity at the heart of their role. It is the responsibility of all of our head teachers, all of our teachers, all of our support staff and all of our central staff within education to meet the needs of children and young people and those with additional support needs. So it is always difficult when asked by auditors and external people from a local authority point of view of how much is your spend on additional support needs, because we see the meeting of the broad range of additional support needs within the definition that we have in Scotland as being everyone's responsibility.
Vivian?
Yeah, I mean, I'll just own up and say I can't possibly answer a question about needs-led budgeting, so I'm glad other people could, but I would wholeheartedly agree with the points that have been made. I think that within education, we very much see ourselves working in partnership with other key agencies such as health to meet additional support needs, to work with family support services to meet additional support needs. And so to try and single out the spend that only education makes is quite tricky. And I think it would be a complex issue to look at the wider budgeting issues, but I do think it would be useful. I think that also to try and provide some kind of an answer to that very good question about why does it feel as if there's a message that the spend is going up, but there's, resources have never been tighter. I think we're in a really tricky stage just now where the identification of additional support needs has never been better or more effective. We're very, very good at identifying what young people's needs are right from across the whole range of the ASL Act spectrum. And as Lynn has said, some of these needs will be complex and long-term, some of them will be short-term and may relate to, for example, issues of bereavement or, family breakup through a parent going into prison. All of these things fall under the description of additional support needs. So that's one of the reasons, I think, why there are such high proportions of additional support needs of young children and young people in school, because we recognise now the range of different needs that there are. Not all of these needs need the same level of intensive support and intervention, but they do need recognition. And I think also one of the things that's been tricky, I think it's been getting increasingly tricky, and it's been exacerbated by COVID, but I'm not blaming COVID, although it was a trigger point, is that the kind of explosion in needs and family concerns about their children have largely been centred on schools since COVID, and it's meant that a lot of services have really had to work at the kind of crisis intervention high level. And what we're very keen to do, and we've talked about this within ASPEP, that's the Principal Educational Psychologists Organisation, with ADES in collaboration, is that we're very keen to pause, look at what's going on, and see how we can move back to a focus on early intervention and prevention, because we know that that's where we really need to invest time, resources, expertise, in order to intervene early, to support families before things become a crisis, to support children in school to ensure that they have the building blocks to be able to engage in that environment. And to do that, we need our partners on board with that as well. And I can't speak for them, but I do hear from the partnership work that we do locally in Fife that they feel the same pressures to be intervening at a crisis intervention level when they really want to get in at the ground floor to be able to intervene before things get to that stage. So I think that the whole landscape is really complex. Sorry if I've gone beyond the scope of the question there.
Kerry, from a Falkirk perspective, what are your thoughts on that question?
Yeah, so I suppose there's different ways of looking at it. If you take a whole systems approach, the children who are leaving our schools either at P7 or at S6 have probably got less need than the children coming in at P1 and S1. So I can understand why people feel that there's kind of growing needs at the more complex end of the spectrum. And we've still got the same resource. So if you're splitting that equitably and fairly, it might feel a bit reduced. Certainly in Falkirk, before the pandemic, we had started to increase our specialist provision spaces, especially the ones that were attached to our primary schools. And that was to kind of be based on the projected five-year needs, and where we are is a new projection of need. So it's about using your resources really creatively, and our schools are amazing at using resources creatively, but they're taking a very individualised learner approach. So they are looking at what would meet that learner's needs best. So it is becoming very individual, it's becoming very child-centric, and therefore they will then ask for more support and resources. So it's just about how we manage those requests, how we manage that support. Is the support going in the right place? So as the Morgan Review said, we have to reimagine our mainstream. Certainly in Falkirk, that's where we are just now. We're reimagining what our stage three provision looks like. That's for our children who do require more complex kind of external agency support. And they seem to be growing in numbers. So it's just making sure we've got the right resource going to those children at the right time. And again, at that early intervention and prevention level. So we've already done that with our specialist provisions. Our standalone schools have seen a big shift in the complexity of needs. So they've changed their curriculum, they've changed their model, and our mainstream schools are now looking at what needs to change and grow in our own curriculum, in our own model that will allow us to meet all of the needs of the children that we have coming to us. So I think that's the kind of position we are in Falkirk. So I don't think it's that need is necessarily, it's the resource isn't shrinking, it's just we need to look at it and help it become more flexible again.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. And Ben McPherson, back to yourself now. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Moving on to a wider question, which is how does a staged intervention work in practice? Be interested in any feedback that panellists want to give us on that. You know, does a child or a young person have to have unmet need at stage one before being considered for greater levels of support?
Dr. Binney, Lynn.
Most, if not all, local authorities will have a staged assessment model in place. They do differ across local authorities, as you would expect. They're based in legislation, they're based around good practice. Most talk about universal level of support. So I suppose, take a step back at the moment, they're there to allow local authorities to help support local authorities plan for resource, to assess and plan resource, and to really assure that the principle of least intrusive intervention is in place, and that is that the small adaptations to the environment, the curriculum, the learning can meet the majority of our children's needs. We talk about that being the universal, and then there are increasingly intensive interventions as you move through the staged assessment approach within a local authority, often with special schools and out with schools being at the highest level of intervention that we would want for our children and young people. The principle is that the majority of learners' needs will be met within universal level, that is within the classroom, through adaptations that the teacher can make through their practice, their differentiation, their learning environment. And the aspect that is really important is that those least intrusive interventions should always be put in place first and foremost before you would jump to more intensive interventions, such as removing the child from the classroom, removing the child from school, adapting the curriculum significantly. So that's the basis of our staged assessment models. I would disagree that leads to unmet need in the majority of cases. It should ensure that the majority of children's needs are met in the classroom through differentiation and minor adjustments and amendments and being made to their learning. And really, they need to be put in place. They need to be tried and tested and reviewed over a period of time before more intensive interventions would get in place by the class teacher or indeed the school, before therefore then moving to local authority interventions such as smaller peripatetic outreach teams, intensive one-to-one support, access to educational psychology support, or indeed access to the many third sector partners that we have in our schools to support children. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, just for clarity, I wasn't saying that the child had to have unmet need. The question was, does the young person or child have to have unmet need at stage one before being considered for greater levels of support? So your answer to that is no, is what I'm taking. Is that correct?
I would say no.
Yeah. Okay. So the journey into another stage is much more complicated and determined by a variety of factors. Is that
what
I should interpret from your answer?
Yes. Yeah. So those needs first and foremost being identified, assessed in the classroom by the class teacher as part of their planning for the class.
Thank you, Dr. Bennett.
Vivian Sutherland.
I would agree, you know, absolutely with Lynn's description there. And of course, every local authority does it slightly differently. And I think the way that you've summarised that is absolutely what I would agree. We've worked really hard to try and make it so that there are no barriers put in place, for example, from moving from universal to additional. It's a collaborative and agreed approach with the family that there's been a need identified. We've tried some low-level interventions. Some of those have been successful to an extent, some of those haven't, but we recognise that there are still needs that we need to further address, and so we might put in additional levels of support to do that. What I would say is that I find that in all schools, staff are very proactive at assessing young people's needs and identifying any concerns at an early stage and putting in supports within their own gift before even coming to the stage of necessarily needing to formalise those in a plan. So things that classroom teachers will do just within their own teaching, consultation that they'll have with their own learning support staff to do small interventions to see whether that can make a difference without there having to be any kind of more intrusive intervention or anything that might make the child feel singled out in the classroom. However, as soon as there are any concerns like that, the families are always involved in knowing what the school are putting in place. And certainly what we do, I can't speak for every local authority, but I know that every local authority does a version of this, is that we try to have very clear, straightforward, simple, understandable paperwork to write down what it is that we've identified in terms of what those child's needs are, what the parents' views on that are, and what we're doing about it, so that when we come back together, we review those interventions using that paperwork where the child and the parent both have the opportunity to have their say on that as well. And that that document is carried right through from children who have just the smallest need that needs to be met, right through to children with very complex needs. The plan can just become bigger or smaller, depending on what needs to be in it. So I think that the staged approach is really important, because we need to be able to identify, you know, what we have at each level that we can put in place. But I think that it also is characterised by being very flexible and very fluid, and we try really hard to make it so that it's not bureaucratic and there isn't a sense of you have to achieve this many points or be failing at this level for us to go to the next stage. It's not about that. It's about like trying to identify what's working, what's still not working yet, what else can we do. So that's our approach, I would say, across local authorities, and that's, you know, I can speak for how we deliver that in Fife.
And Kerry, do you want to come in on that as well, please?
Thank you. I suppose the staged intervention is a framework and a tool, and it just enables consistency and understanding, that shared understanding across all of our partners, our parents, our young people. Everybody can access it and understand it. And it's used as a strength-based approach rather than a deficit model. So again, it's based on what does the child need to allow them to thrive at this time, and depending on what their circumstances are, what their need are, it's not a linear journey from universal to stage four, because there are so many things that can happen to our young people that they might need an intervention from a specialist agency, which is very clearly at stage three or stage four, for a short amount of time or for a longer amount of time. So the model is flexible. Children can move in and out of those stages, but it is a strength-based model. So it is meant to be what are the strengths, what's going well for the child, what has the child got within them that's going really well, and where do we need to offer additional support. So it's not about that's an unmet need, that's going really badly. We're moving away from that kind of negative language and way of looking at young people and saying what are their strengths, what do they need that would really help them at this time. So that I think it's that right support at the right time at any stage of the model. And our model, we map so much information to it. We map our CLPL training to it so that it teachers and practitioners, career-long professional learning. So all of the training courses that are on offer from all of your partners, and it is a partnership approach. So everybody can look at the staged intervention model and say, well, these are other strategies and supports that I can put in place for this young person, because this looks like what they require at this time, and that's to do with the planning at the team around the child. But it is a framework and a tool, and I think it's our practitioners find it really useful. And it gives that consistency of approach across all of our schools, wherever our young people may be. And so it gives a bit more confidence for our parents. And our parents who've... we shared that with them at a parent forum recently, and they were really interested in it and wanted to know more about it. And it gave them a sense of confidence in the system as well, that there is this framework, that there are supports and there are things that can happen that they can be empowered to know about as well, and they can ask for it if it's not happening. So it was part of that. Thank you.
All three of you for that clarity and those explanations, very helpful. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Ben McPherson. Michelle Thompson, please.
Good morning, panel. Thank you for joining us. We know that supporting ASN needs requires a multi-agency approach. So I'm interested, and I'll come to yourself, Kerry, first, for probably obvious reasons, given that I represent Falkirk East. But I'm interested in how you ensure your strategy allows for the inclusion of all key stakeholders, and I'm thinking health boards, social work, and so on.
Yeah, so I suppose what we do is we use what we call a locality model or a closer to home model. So we try and explain it. So we have clusters. So in a cluster, you would have a high school and all its associated primaries. And each cluster has a named person to go to in an agency. So after COVID, we developed our social work teams to map into specific clusters. So there was always a named team manager that schools could go to, as well as a specific duty worker for social work. So the duty worker might attend the TAC if there wasn't an allocated social worker. The team around the child, the meeting. And we have a model where we have a service level agreement with our allied health professionals for speech and language services and physiotherapy. So we have named clinicians who are mapped to that cluster. who are there at that first point of call, so a school can ask for advice. They've got a named person that they can contact immediately, as do the families. We also extend that to our educational psychology. We have a link to every school, and in my team I have what we call additional support needs advisors, and my advisors have two clusters that they look after and work with. So there's always a kind of clear link for a parent to know who to contact, for the school to know who to contact, for those people to be the first people to be invited to the team around the child to offer assistance and support. And I know that with the speech and language partners and our physiotherapy partners, that's a new model that we brought about in the last few years, and it has been quite transformative, and it's certainly reduced waiting times. It's increased the expertise of our school staff. We use the model of therapy partners now, so it's our school staff who are working on the advice of those specialists and delivering the right kind of strategies in school to the young people. So has that answered your question?
No, it has. And Vivian, I imagine there's a multitude of different approaches. What can you tell us about how Fife achieves this?
Well, what I would say is I would agree with everything that you've said there about how we can structure ourselves with our partners to try and work most effectively together and to get the best kind of most responsive interventions. I think it's tricky working across multi-agency partners, because I think we all agree that children are in education between 9 and 4-ish every day, but they have lives out with that as well, and their needs don't stop just when they, you know, leave the school gate. So we really rely on our partners, whether it's family support or health partners or so on, to be able to provide the kind of care and support that obviously goes out with the school day as well, even if the need is identified in school. I think we work really hard at a strategic level to try and have very good and strong partnerships with health and social care and social work and family support. And I think that we do have very good links in most local areas too, but there are barriers to that we're working really hard to try and resolve just now. For example, in Fife just now, we're working really hard with our health partners to try and streamline referral paperwork for young people, because there are a lot of services out there. Often the requirement to access those services comes back to the school, to action, and one of the issues that we know we're dealing with is just the workload on school of having to complete multiple different referrals from multiple different services. So we're trying to tackle that directly within Fife, and we have great buy-in from our partners about the need to resolve that. But it won't be a straightforward or quick resolve, because everybody has their own referral paperwork for very good reasons. You know, they've developed it over years because it contains the information that they need. But we are trying to work together to say, how can we make sure that we provide the kind of information that schools hold, but we also, you know, do that in a proportionate way that allows families and young people contact with the health services at the earliest possible opportunity, so they can then start to intervene and gather the health-specific information that they need. So it's a complex landscape, and it always will be, and with a complex landscape there is no quick fix, but I think it's really important to invest time in the longer term fixes that are actually going to sustain and that are going to then lead us to better partnership, proper collaborative work with families and our partners in the end. So that's a long answer, and I hope it helps, but I think it's important to kind of highlight that it can be tricky sometimes, but we don't look away from that. We try and face that and think, well, how can we work through that trickiness? Yes.
And can I bring in yourself now here, Anthony? I appreciate this is a very complex question and area, but what similarities, differences and challenges do you see with your view across all local authorities? Because, of course, there are rightly and justifiably a number of different approaches trying to get to the same outcome. Have you got any view that you can add to this?
Yeah, I mean, as people have already said on the panel, this is complex and not easy stuff. Yeah. I think our observation would be, based on the work we've done on partnerships, is a lot of this is really dependent on good relationships and trust and a shared understanding of where people are coming from. But there are inevitably potential tensions between the priorities of different partners, resource pressures and so on and so forth. But I think people do recognise that and work together on it. I'd echo the kind of comments that people have made around that. Yeah, so that, I guess that's what I'm
Thank
say.
You, Lynn, I can see.
I think I would agree, but would maybe want us to take us further down the a conversation around the tension. There is inevitably tension when working across different partners and their different thresholds. And I think, linked to Vivian's point, some of the frustration around parents and some of their need to fight the system, for want of a better word, is around the complexity and, and the thresholds, and that all sitting within the school as the named person or as the person who devises and supports the planning for children, and the workload on school staff. Many of our partner agencies can shift their service delivery, their thresholds, as a result of the work that they are doing within their service, which can inadvertently affect the impact on school staff, speech and language therapy. And I knew that you, I know that you heard from Glenn in a recent panel. They're an essential partner for school staff. They often work now in consultancy with school staff, whereby they advise school staff on how to deliver the intervention in the classroom to the child. And it's the school staff that now deliver many of those interventions. The same can be said for my colleagues in CAMHS, who will offer advice and training to school staff to deliver the interventions in school. And these are some of the tensions and the workload pressures that schools are finding themselves increasingly in. And I'm sure there will be conversations around CSP criteria, and that tension is directly linked to some of the low levels of CSPs that we see in our schools. The other complex nature of this work is our clusters, our learning communities, are all very different, and that is for good reasons, as a result of empowerment of schools, certain criteria that Scottish Government set around CEF and PEF, local schools and local communities having to look for resources in their local area to meet the needs of the children in their school. Therefore, sometimes local authority level, we are not always cited on the resources that are available to support schools. The onus is on schools to understand their area, the resources that are there, and to communicate that to parents. So it's a very complex landscape.
Mm-hmm. I think you've illustrated that perfectly. Thank you.
And CEF and PEF, for those listening, is Strategic Equity Fund and Pupil Equity Fund. We are in a world of jargon, so I'm just making it clear. So that's super. Can I now come to questions from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. Vivian, I'd just like to pick up on something you said in response to one of my colleagues, and now I can't remember who it was. It was a wee while ago. It was about that desire to move from crisis to prevention. And I think you were speaking sort of particularly in terms of kind of post-pandemic. But I guess that's been a bit of a theme for our public services in Scotland for quite a long time. I'd just be interested to hear a bit more about what needs to happen to give the space to do that, if you like.
First. Thank you. Yeah, I think it's a really good question, and I think that if I had an easy answer for that, then I'd be really delighted. I think that I think it's tricky because the work is relentless, and schools feel, I think, sometimes quite overwhelmed with the need to support the range of pupils that they have, and when there's worry about supporting pupils, then everybody's thoughts go to those who are at the top end of the triangle, the ones who are most at risk of poor outcomes, ones who are most challenging to support, and so on. And that's a natural kind of human characteristic, and it feels natural to focus on those first. However, I think that there almost is a need for us, and I think this ASL inquiry is a helpful forum to maybe just to talk about this, to just pause. Everybody is working extremely hard within the education service, within councils, within partners. But sometimes I think what we need to do is pause, stop, and think, how can we refresh? How can we reallocate resources? How can we ensure, yes, that the worst outcomes don't happen for those who are most vulnerable, but we actually start to look, more upstream. And I don't just mean at early intervention, as in preschool and early primary, although I do mean that as well. I mean about the kind of things we've talked about making sure we're intervening really effectively with really effective parental support and really effective multi-agency support when necessary, when needs are first identified, to prevent
to prevent situations escalating.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's an easy way to do that, but I think there needs to be a kind of collaborative will to do that so that we all agree that that's a step.
So I suppose I'm going to press you. I realise if we had the answer to this question, it would be amazing. We could all probably walk out and implement it and do it, and it's not straightforward. But just to press a little bit, I suppose the notion of pausing. Pause what? What do we require to pause? Because as you say, everyone's for early intervention and prevention until we get to the point where we have to stop doing something. So I suppose it'd be helpful for the committee to try and understand how the system could take that pause. What would need to happen? If it's too, I get that's quite a big question.
Nicola? Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've started to touch on there's three threads in my mind about how we move. I think we've got a massive opportunity around about public service reform, and I say public service reform, not local government reform, quite deliberately. I think we've heard of some of the tensions already from colleagues on the panel. We need to start looking at what we're measuring and does it matter? We've had a conversation on spend on additional support needs in a particular line in the local government budget. That means we're not having a conversation about where else is that spend and where else could we better be using that spend. So I think the work that Anthony's good offices might step forward and do around about following the public pound for children who are in the system in this nature, I think there's something about us working out where are we spending the money, because I suspect what we're doing at the moment with children in some cases who have additional support needs is that we're spending the money too late and it's much, much more expensive. And that means we need to make sure we've got the right workforce available in the health service to deal with low-level issues. We need to make sure we've got the right workforce available in the schools and in the surrounding communities and all of those sort of things. So I think for me it's about understanding what good looks like, and that's where we need to understand the problem as opposed to saying we can fix additional support need issues with additional teachers or... So we have to be careful we don't do what we've always done, which is focus in on very, very specific measures that don't look at outcomes. So that's the first part. The second part is follow the money and agree that we move the money into prevention as opposed to crisis intervention. And the third thing for me is around about what does the future workforce need to look like? Because I don't think we understand why we've seen such a jump. I think we can guess some of it's COVID, some of it's complexity, but some of it might be the knock-on impact to waitlists in the NHS or the knock-on impact on housing and homelessness, and we just don't understand that. So apologies if that was a bit gobbled, but
no,
for me it's three strands.
Okay.
Anthony?
I'm afraid that Nicola's rather stolen my thunder, to be perfectly honest. But what I would say is when I think Lynn was responding to your question, Michelle, she talked about the importance of multi-agency working and the impact of partners on local authorities. And that obviously works in the other direction as well, the impact of local authorities on partners. For me, the only way we're going to get a shift towards prevention is if we see public service reform as being about a cross-public sector programme. So it's about local government, Scottish Government, health and their third sector partners and communities having a shared understanding about what they need to do to change the models and allocation of resources for public service in areas. Additional support for learning is an example of how difficult that can be. But it doesn't just need to be done for additional support for learning. It needs to be done for health prevention. It needs to be done for preventing crime and disorder. And the way in which the panels have been talking about the need to see the child and the family as being the point of entry for this, I think is fundamental. You know, the only way we're going to get more efficient, more productive, preventative public services if we start planning public services around the needs of individuals and communities, not around particular services or programmes of work. Sorry, that was a rather abstract response, but and there aren't any easy answers here, because I think Nicola implies this, but...
I'll maybe just pause you for a second, because I don't think you would get any disagreement from anyone in the room about the need for public services to wrap around children, families, whoever the service users are. I think my question is about what do practitioners need, because I could imagine, I think all of us appreciate the strain that our public services are under in terms of demand and workforce, and would acknowledge and appreciate just how hard everybody's working. I would think that some of the kind of high-level talk about that, about, you know, restructuring public services, would just cause alarm amongst practitioners. And I guess what I'm interested in is what do people working with children
on the ground now need to make things better for children at the moment? And maybe that's a question for folk who are doing that.
Kerry, you look keen to ask.
Thank you. I suppose the example I'm going to give is of the NHS, when they were looking at mental health and wellbeing, and they were putting all the resources at that. Like, if we think about suicide, that very clinical end point, and if you're missing out putting the resources into your earlier intervention, you just get a tipping point, so that as people unfortunately go to that more clinical needs support, if they're not getting the early support, they need it right at the other end, then you get a tipping point where you're putting all of your resource to that, and you're freeing even less to the early intervention and prevention. So in order to redress the balance, so first saying that we're getting increasing numbers of children with complex needs at that kind of stage three and stage four, how do we intervene earlier to stop that tipping all the resources to that end of the continuum, to that very expensive resource of a specialist provision placement? So for me, and I think this is what I hear from my schools and my families, is it's about one of the best things you can do is reduce the ratios of staff to children as early as possible. And the example I'm going to give you is in our nurseries. Our children have an adult to child ratio of 1 to 8. You go into P1 and it's 1 to 25. You're in a special school and it's 1 teacher for 6. So that just kind of shows you the kind of difference. So I think a lot, the system has to change, that the curriculum has to evolve, the strategies we use have to evolve to meet the needs of the learners that we've got in front of us. And I think everybody understands that and agrees that. But if you're trying to meet the needs, diverse needs of a class of 25 in P1, but your specialist setting has only got 6 children with diverse needs, and they're very bespoke and attached to them, you can understand why there feels like there's not enough support in the system. So I would say if you want to get it right, you reduce the ratios or reduce your class sizes. I think that's one of the first steps, in line with all the other things like evolving your curriculum and making sure it's person-centred. So and I think that relates to what the NHS started to do. They put more money into Tier 2 resources to prevent that Tier 4 clinical support. So I think that's kind of what I was trying to say, is just to put something in the system early, and for me it would be staff ratios.
Vivian?
I'll just give one other very brief example, because I do think it's important to have kind of concrete examples of things that we could do. So, for example, one of the real bottlenecks for us are children coming into nursery and then up into primary one who have underdeveloped language skills, which are a real barrier lifelong, because struggling with language means often that children struggle to develop literacy skills. We know that literacy is your key to unlocking the door to the curriculum and, you know, achievement in later life. So I think that there are reasons for this, that they're linked up with the pandemic and so on, but that, you know, regardless of that, we need to tackle it now. And I do think that some things that we're looking at in Fife, and I know other local authorities are looking at, is what kind of support can we provide for families when children are very young, before they even come into the school system, to help them develop their language skills, to help families understand how to develop those skills, and also, importantly, how to help families understand how to develop the kind of social skills in their children, which come about through being with other children in different play environments, so that children learn those really important early skills of how you self-regulate when you're in a group with other people and so on. Because all of these things are your prerequisites to coming into school and having a successful experience. Because, of course, we want to make the school environment friendly to all kinds of children with all kinds of needs. But we do know that schools, of course, are learning institutions, all kinds of learning. And so if children come in there with the kind of readiness of language that they can use to communicate well, listen well, and communicate with others, and they already have the understanding of how you cope successfully in a social group, then you're you've got a head start there to be able to access the school curriculum. So these are some of the things. I know the Family Wellbeing Fund is looking at all these types of areas. I think it's really important that we focus, and you know, that's I think a practical example of how we could shift our resources and our expertise into ensuring that that's put in place at an early enough stage to try and reduce the number of children who are coming into school who then struggle because of these barriers that they have.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Okay, thank you. Stephanie Callaghan, now please.
Thanks, convener. I'm going to ask about buildings rather than people now. And I'm wondering, have new school buildings been designed with the needs of pupils with sensory needs in mind? And how do local authorities adapt their existing schools as well to help ensure that young people can access the appropriate support too? So I don't know.
Well, Dr. Binney, perhaps? Yeah.
I think our environment in which we teach our young people is very important, and unfortunately can lead to additional support needs in many ways. I think we heard from the panel one this morning around the needs of children with autism and their needs to be in a low sensory stimulated environment where sound and light adjustments are made. I think we could do more nationally, either through ADES or with other partners, to look at research and evidence and how we make our buildings more inclusive to meet the needs of children and young people. I think the design of buildings are often determined at local authority level through different approaches, perhaps involving professionals such as architects who might not always understand or know around the needs of the complexity of children that we see within the current system and we project within the future of our buildings. And I think it's certainly something that I think needs much more attention to ensure that we're getting it right. So that's for our new build schools.
So can I just ask you on that then? So would you say, for example, architects that ASN needs to be a key principle that's right up there?
It should be.
Design.
I know my experience in my previous local authority and this my new local authority are that we're around those tables really early to put forward our advice, and we involve children and young people and parents in that. I think we could be doing more. Within my current local authority, we've worked in collaboration with researchers at Edinburgh University to look at inclusive learning environments and how we can shift the learning environment to get it right for the majority of our children in schools. It's lovely when you hear children and young people's views on that. So I think there's lots of projects. I think there's lots of really good new builds. I think there's amendments to existing builds. But I still think that there are significant barriers. And I think across Scotland there are significant barriers to existing estates within mainstream and our special schools that I think we could do more work around getting it right and ensuring our buildings are fit for purpose.
You want to come in too?
So it would be remiss of me as COSLA not to say that it's really important that all of that incredible work is taken forward when we're discussing capital review programmes with Scottish Government and how local government is funded on that, because I think what we've heard there is amazing. That's exactly what we would all like to see, is our children and young people around the table telling us what they want from our schools. But that's got to be borne out in the capital programmes that come forward to pay for the school estate.
So I suppose just on the point of existing schools there as well, are there things around lighting and around creating spaces and things, perhaps, Dr. Binney, that you could say?
There is,
on?
I think we discuss this at ADES quite regularly. I think we're also very aware that some of our schools are not adaptable, and some can't be adaptable given the age, and some schools are listed, for example. So we still, I think there are still examples where we struggle for accessibility, for wheelchair access across all our schools. I think it's an increasing difficulty and has been more pronounced perhaps as a result of the pandemic and issues over costs and building supplies and access to a workforce to do some of the amendments that are required. It's like a constant challenge and discussion at local authority level around how we do adapt our buildings to meet the increasing needs and to keep children safe. So I don't think we've got that right.
Okay. Just moving on.
I was just wondering if either Vivian or Kerry wanted to comment on the adaptations that could happen to existing buildings from their specific local authority areas. If you don't need to, if you don't have anything.
Yeah, I was just going to come in and say that I think our high schools are very modern and are able to adapt, and our schools are very, very creative. about what they do in the classroom. And I think if you walked into a primary classroom, you would see little nooks, little safe areas. We have children with weighted blankets that there are like kind of like little nooks and crannies, and it's all very soft, it's all very sensory. But there's also our educational psychology service will do what they call an environmental audit of if you've got young people with more neurodivergent needs in your classroom, they will come and support and say, this is what how you reduce your walls, these are the colours that you should use, this is what your displays can look like. So they're trying to reduce the sensory overload, they try and reduce the transitions, that they try and reduce the unpredictability. So I agree there are bigger things about the estate. It does need to be more modern, but there are lots of things that you can do in a classroom to reduce those barriers without having to spend a lot of money.
So is there perhaps a need then to learn a bit from primary schools and take that into secondary schools?
You would start to see that now. And I think that with the kind of transition planning that some of our first-year classes are starting to look more like the primary. It's harder to do in the high school. But I think that what high schools do is they tend to have a space where young people can access. So they can go to access it rather than it being in a space in every single classroom, which would be quite hard to achieve. So they kind of have what we call zones where young people can go and they might be able to deregulate or have some one-to-one support. But it's a reduced sensory environment that they can go to at times for brain breaks and for other things.
So is that kind of space something that should be a minimum in all schools, that there should be somewhere like that that's accessible all the time throughout the school day?
Yeah, I think that's something that we would want to promote, and that's certainly the kind of conversations that we're having with our schools. And we've our educational psychologists have just done that with a couple of schools where they have built kind of like what we would call neurodivergent bases, like a room that's geared up towards those young people with those kind of needs. It's very reduced sensory stimulation. They can go and do learning there and then get back to the mainstream. The only other thing that I was going to say was things evolve, and the transition and the planning is really key in making all of this happen and making sure that our schools are fit for purpose for their learners' journey as our young children translate from primary to high school. So a lot of learning from the primaries is going into the high schools, and we've even got primary teachers employed in our high schools as well, because they're really good at doing the blended kind of curriculum for young people who are maybe first level curriculum and maybe not quite ready to access that high school curriculum but still want to go there.
It's a really interesting
Vivienne and Lynn want to come in on this, okay, as well. Stephanie.
Thanks very much. I'll just talk briefly about secondary school. We have a wide range of secondary schools in terms of brand new builds and old buildings as well. But all our secondary schools over the last year have done a lot of really great work on setting out and describing what they call their continuum of support, and making that a really accessible document that's shared with the primary schools and can be shared with families, so that it's really clearly understood what there is in the continuum of support, from just being in the classroom with the class teacher, learning your subject, right through to spending quite a lot of your day or your week in a very supported base with small numbers and specialist staff who are able to support you and support you out into the mainstream school when possible, and everything in between. And what our schools are also working up alongside this is a kind of, this is at an earlier stage, but what is our continuum of emotional support? You know, what do we as a school have access to support young people's well-being, and to ensure that, you know, their well-being needs are being met as well as their learning needs? And that, again, goes right from the care of a class teacher, noticing things, guidance staff, but then right through to the kind of most intensive levels of support that the school has within their gift to give. For example, counselling in schools, access to sensory rooms, you know, whatever might be necessary. And those are a bit different in all of our schools. They're the same kind of broad approaches that we would want to have, you know, this continuum. But the schools adapt it depending on what their environment allows and supports, what their building can do and so on. But it's a step to try and make that clearer for parents, young people, and for the primary schools, who are often anxious about their kids with needs coming up to the high school, and they need to know what is there almost regardless of the type of building that there is, that's going to be able to meet their needs. So again, just a kind of concrete description of an example of something that's in place.
Dr. Binney?
I'm really pleased to hear of those adaptations that school buildings, that local authorities have put into school buildings. I would suggest that is replicated across all local authorities, which makes our mainstream schools cater for the majority of needs of which we have in our local authorities. And when I think to often that conflict with some small number of parents around mainstreaming, it is often because they perceive mainstream as being the environment in which they may be attended school. And I think that the work that local authorities perhaps need to do more of is to share some of the adaptations to the buildings and the modifications that have been made to meet the range of needs. So whilst I would suggest that there's further work to do in this area to understand our buildings and our spaces to meet the needs of our learners, I think there's a lot of work already happening, and perhaps that's that communication issue with parents around the range of needs and supports that are now in our mainstream schools to meet the needs of our learners.
Stephanie, still?
Can I just pick up on that point, Dr. Binney? You're saying a very small number of parents and their kind of perception of what's going on. But I suppose, going back to what Pam started out with today, there seem to be quite a large number of parents that feel like everything's a fight. Everything's a fight all the way through. And I know certainly, Kerry, you touched on earlier on about how the framework tool, something that when you spoke to parents about it, they got that kind of understanding. They were really keen to know more. And I'm just wondering if there's a real need, perhaps, for things like the framework tool and perhaps access to, goodness, what were they called that were here earlier on? Losing my track here, my rights, my say, that these kind of things are discussed proactively as soon as an additional support needs is kind of recognised, just to kind of pull together, I suppose, the parents and the young person as well, and have them feel like they've got access to the information that they need to, which possibly helps the teachers as well. I'm just wondering if that's something that you think would be helpful or...
Yeah. Definitely. One of the things that we were planning with our ASN advisors was for them to kind of host an event in their clusters and just kind of demystify some of our ASN processes and procedures. We've done quite a lot of updating to them, and just to really make sure everything's fair and equitable and transparent. And we need to take that back to the parents. It was work that we had tried to do before kind of COVID struck, but then we've done quite a lot of revision then. So we've worked with Enquire as well. We've created modules with them that we're delivering to our staff, so that our staff and our practitioners can have those conversations, because they're empowered, they understand how it works, they can encourage our children and young families to have their voice, basically, and know their rights and know how they can have remedy and have access to it. So we have a handbook that goes out to all of our practitioners. We have every school has an ASN, an additional support needs coordinator, and it's their kind of role to make sure they're getting it right for the young people in their school. So we're trying to engage with them more frequently and make sure they understand the laws, the rights, so that they are the ones that can empower the parents as well, so that parents don't feel there's barriers, that they don't feel they have to look for information, they don't feel that they kind of have to fight, because they'll actually get the answers to the questions in that way. And one of the other things that we've put in place is the Parent Plus programme. So we're working with groups of parents. We trialled it at transition level, because certainly at transition, that's a really difficult time for parents and young people leaving school. So we trialled that, and the Parents Plus programme helps parents help other parents. It's kind of like a peer support programme, navigate some of the difficulties and some of the challenges of going through additional support needs. And I think, Pam, when you said that parents feel that they have to fight, I think it's because they feel that they've got barriers that are quite insurmountable, quite institutionalised, and they feel like they're having to fight all the time. So why would that be any different when they feel that they have to ask at school? And it's something that we're trying to certainly take any fight out of them. We're saying, you've got ASN advisors, they can advocate for you, you've got access to the support. Every school has a linked advocacy worker for their young people that they can signpost them to. So we are definitely trying to change that perception and trying to work with our parents and trying to demystify some of those processes.
And I suppose there is that perception, in fact, they spoke about it earlier on this morning, that a formal diagnosis can actually really help meet young people's needs. And I'm wondering, under what circumstances would that actually be the case? I don't know if that might actually be more a question for Vivian.
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that. I've worked as an educational psychologist for over 25 years now, and we've always worked to the principle that it is not necessary to have a diagnosis of any kind of need in order to access support. The support will be put in place when a need is identified, and if it helps parents or the young person to have a diagnosis, we'll support them to seek that diagnosis, but the support they get won't be dependent on that, because we want to intervene at the earliest possible stage when anybody identifies concerns, whether that's around dyslexia or autism or ADHD type difficulties. If a child is having difficulty with literacy or social communication or impulsivity, we want to intervene to actually try and address that difficulty regardless of whether a diagnosis is in fact sought or given. And some parents are very keen on diagnosis because it helps them to understand the difficulty that their child has, and that's great, we'll support them along the pathway for that. Some parents are very resistant to diagnosis because they don't want their child labelled. We are also fine with that. We will support the parents through their journey and the child through their journey regardless. I also think that, you know, we try to look ahead to think about, you know, we don't want to be in the business of unintended consequences. And we do know that, you know, if we made the mistake of saying, well, you'll need to get a diagnosis of, for example, ASD before you'll have access to this level of support in school, all that would do is clog up the ASD diagnosis pathway with people who felt that they needed to achieve that before they could get support. So our focus is very much on, tell us what you feel is the support that you need that you're not getting right now. We'll tell you what we think on the basis of our assessment of your child's needs, what might help, but let's come together on that and let's agree what we're going to do and let's put that in place. And if you wish to pursue diagnosis, then absolutely we'll do that, but we'll do that alongside the primary important task of supporting your child in school. So I'm not saying that diagnosis is irrelevant. If it's important to families, it's important. But it's certainly not something upon which support is contingent in school.
Lynn.
Yeah, I'd just like to make a small point to that. I absolutely agree wholeheartedly with that, and that is the strength of the Scottish education legislation in the world that we work in. I do have to note that that is the case for education services. It is not always the case for partner agencies, whereby they do they need a diagnosis to access specifically post-school services. And I think we need to be... I think I need to stress that with the committee.
That's helpful to make that distinction and get that on the record.
Yes.
So that, I suppose, leads on to some of the evidence we heard last week, specifically from May Dinsmuir and some parents. They've told us that local authorities have been a bit dismissive of their understanding of their children's needs. And as I said, May Dinsmuir spoke last week about masking, which is when the was not being addressed properly by local authorities, and some of the behaviours the young people were masking in their educational environments, and then when they got home, things got very challenging. So we're wondering about what local authorities might be thinking about doing in terms of tackling that, something which is what we've heard quite loud and clear over our last evidence. And how do you work with parents and carers to identify the needs that are not necessarily apparent in that school setting? So I'm looking at the three to the right of the panel. We would want Vivian, do you want to go first?
I'll come in first with that. I think it's a really important and topical issue to talk about. And I'm probably going to be a bit blunt and a bit controversial, so apologies.
Please
in advance.
Do.
I think that my own view is that masking in and of itself is not necessarily a good or a bad thing. It isn't necessarily one of these things. I think the NAET guidance is very helpful about masking, and I think that my own view on it is that masking is actually something which all of us in society do to an extent in lots of different situations when we put a face on a situation that is stressful for us, like coming here today to talk to a committee at the Scottish Parliament. I think that what's really important to assess is the functionality of that for the young person, because quite often young people feel that they do want to perhaps adapt their behaviour to fit in a situation that would be stressful otherwise. But the cut-in score for me is, if that's causing distress to the young person, and if we're hearing from the family that that's causing negative impacts at home, or that it's becoming dysfunctional for the young person, then of course that's something that we wish to address and discourage and make sure that we address the underlying factors. But I think it's tricky if we just polarise the debate, and I know that nobody in here is doing that because it's been a really wide-ranging debate today, but if we polarise it to being it's always bad or it's always good, that's a problem. And I know it's a typical psychologist response to say, well, it depends. But I think it really does depend. I think masking is something we need to be very aware of. I think that it is a really important issue because a lot of young people may well be presenting relatively well in school, but there are significant evidence from the home situation or other situations that they are in distress. We need to listen to that, and we need to then dig up what's underneath that so that if there are things in the school context that we can address to reduce the distress, because the distress is the ultimate symptom, that's the thing that we want to affect. To reduce the distress, then that's what we do. And the description of what the child's doing to mask is helpful to us in helping to understand that. But in itself, I don't think it's always a bad thing. Now, my colleagues may disagree with me, but that's the way that we try to dig up and get behind that information, really.
So before we come to other members, in Fife, what do you do if you've got a parent coming to you with an assumption of masking? If we can use those?
Well, and again, you know, I can't be certain that every parent would have exactly the same experience when they come to school saying that, because obviously our staff, you know, might not all respond in the way that we'd wish them to all the time, although we're working on that. But what we would do is we would listen really carefully to what that parent was telling us about the descriptions of the behaviour at home. We'd also try and triangulate that assessment with what the young person's telling us as well. And also, you know, look at other aspects of that child's life beyond the school, out in the community, to see, you know, so how are they, you know, how are they presenting in the youth club? How are they presenting when they go to their music lesson? How are they presenting when they're, you know, in the community on a trip with a youth worker? And try and work out from the various contexts, you know, what are the underlying behaviours that are the underlying situations that allow this child to feel comfortable, ready to take in new information, equipped to face challenges, and how can we create that environment in the school? Even if we're not actually seeing any distressed behaviour in the school, how can we adapt the situations that the child is experiencing day to day to minimise the risk of them having to mask to the extent that their distress is coming out in other ways? So that's a kind of broad answer. Is that answer
it,
your
it
question?
Does help. That's helpful. I'll bring in Lynn and then we'll come to Kerry if that's
I would agree with that. So I would interpret that as a strong assessment, child-based assessment, triangulated, putting the child at the centre of it and looking to see whether the assessment can move out of the school and include part of their behaviours at home. Within Edinburgh, we have an additional support needs outreach service who would visit the home, meet the child and family in the home, and look to see whether they could be supporting the family, perhaps to put the same structures in place that is in place in the school, a visual timetable for perhaps, or some adaptations to the communication style that the child responds to. So I think that we are becoming more aware of the concept of masking. I think we are trying to be flexible in the assessment and approaches that we use within our services. I think we are trying to see the child as being in school for the short time that they're in school, but also understand their world out with school, which is a key focus of GIRFEC, and look to see, you know, perhaps some children are finding the school environment because the adaptations that have been put in place are successful for them, and perhaps sharing them more with the family and with the home and with the other environments in which they access to see whether that can reduce the child's distress. So I think it's happening at a very individual child level at the moment, that team around the child with strong assessment, with the family and the child's views being at the heart of it.
Thank you, Lynn. Kerry, from Falkirk's perspective.
Yeah, we've definitely had this experience. We try and upskill our practitioners so that they understand about masking, and they certainly understand about how it can manifest itself and the difficulties that that can have for parents at home who experience the kind of emotional dysregulation and don't have any understanding of what's caused it or how they could support it. So it's really about having that constant dialogue and conversation. We would definitely ask our schools to look at how to reduce the demand during the day, maybe build in a break right at the very end of the day before the child goes home so that there's some deregulation before they then go back to the family home. But also to work with the family and say, okay, we don't see those behaviours. And so what are the kind of techniques that they would use if the child was dysregulated? What kind of strategies have they used that are successful? And could those be used by the parent? I think it's probably everything that everybody said, but it's something that is quite difficult for parents to manage. But I would say that most of our parents, especially when our children go to high school, it's a similar thing that happens. They come home, they take everything out on the parents, but it's magnified for those children who mask. So it is about making sure that parents don't feel that they're fobbed off, that they are listened to. And we have put out information. In fact, one of our parents offered training on one of our in-service days for that very element. So it's just about, we would say, listen to your parents. They know the child best. That's what's happening. How can we work together to support that and reduce that? Because there is definitely things happening at school that are overloading that young person. And it's all coming out in their safe space with their safe adult. So how can we give them a safe space and a safe adult before they go home to reduce that kind of unsettlement for our parents?
No, that's been helpful. Thank you. I'm going to change tact a little bit in terms of one of the impacts of the pandemic was upon attendance. And we've taken evidence that in some of the deep dive that's been done by the Education Scotland, they published a deep dive into issues around attendance. And one of the groups that reported was being most vulnerable to this was to low attendance as pupils with additional support needs. So I'm just wondering about what local authorities are doing to support children and young people who are continuing to be anxious about attending school, and what are the challenges of developing teachers and learning in a curriculum that's flexible to meet the needs of all the learners. Dr. Binnie Lynn.
I think it's a topic that is very current. I think all local authorities have this on their improvement plan, their improvement agenda. I think the work that Education Scotland done was very helpful. I think local authorities have a good understanding of data around attendance. So I think we are able to identify the young people for whom that we need to do more. I think some of the solutions that are in place are now, as a positive result of the pandemic, we have such a great national and there are local digital education offers that are now in place. And I think that's really helping children and young people who are struggling to access the school building still access their education. And I think I would direct you to eScoil, which is the national programme, which is having great success in enabling children to access education and attain and achieve. I think there are a number of other interventions that are in place, and likewise to my previous response, sometimes the lower interventions are the things that are having great impact. And I think the result of the Scottish Equity Fund and Pupil Equity Fund, we are seeing initiatives such as walking buses, breakfast clubs, pupil support officers, trying to build that relationship with staff, trying to ensure that they see the importance of education and returning to the school. And there are a number of adjustments in place. I think this is something that we might struggle with for the next few years, if not beyond, and we will need to be more flexible around how we see education. I think COVID led to a disruption in the education system for families and children and young people. I think there is increasing evidence of families and children and young people feeling that they don't necessarily feel that the current education system meets their needs, or indeed that they wish to engage in it, and they are seeing learning being able to take place in a broader broader way, perhaps through digital learning specifically. And I think we're yet to really understand the full nature of this. From an ADES perspective, we would strongly feel that curriculum review is necessary, certainly in our secondary schools, and we need to offer a broad range of curriculum. It really meets learners' needs and makes them give them the skills for life, learning and work. And I think we need to understand attendance within that context. Attendance for me is an outcome. It's an outcome of getting it right for our children. It's an outcome of meeting their additional needs, and it's an outcome of having strong teaching, learning and curriculum. And I think I can't distinguish some of the low levels attendance that we're seeing for particular groups. Care experience is one of the groups that I would highlight to with regards to attendance, but I can't help see that as being part of the wider discussion that we need in Scotland around our schools and our curriculum.
Thank you, Lynn. Vivian or Kerry, do either of you want to come in on this? To add anything further?
I would echo everything that Lynn said there. I think that's a really comprehensive overview, and it is an absolute priority for every local authority. I think one of the things that you've highlighted there about children with additional support needs often being most vulnerable to poor attendance, I think that what we're working with our schools to do is to really understand and properly assess the reasons for non-attendance for individual young people, because I think there's a danger to assume that there's a kind of one-size-fits-all solution. For example, we'll refer them to the counselling service if they're saying that they're anxious about coming into school, or we'll reduce the school day because it's too demanding. I think that we're getting much better at doing much more thorough assessment, because usually it's a complex number of reasons that impact upon poor attendance. There's often individual factors for the young person. It might be around anxiety or mood or these type of issues. But it's always, in my experience, interactive with school factors, you know, things to do with the school environment, the school day, the curriculum, their peer relationships, their staff relationships. And almost always there are family factors at play as well. You know, the three elements go together. So I think that we need to have real clarity about what is actually getting in the way of this individual young person's attendance, so that we can put in place a bespoke plan that's going to address those issues for the young person. And that doesn't always mean making significant adaptations to the school environment, but it usually involves making some. But it often involves the family making some changes too, and us providing some support directly to the young person to overcome any internal barriers that they have about attending the school environment. I would say that our schools are really hot on this, and knowing their data and looking really closely at their data and knowing which are the vulnerable groups in terms of needing more support. But I would also say, and I hope this doesn't seem like a flippant remark, but one of the biggest barriers to our schools improving their attendance is often unauthorised family holidays during term time, which is really, really tricky to address. Because it's a financial imperative for families often, and despite the fact that schools work very, very closely with families to try and emphasise the importance of attendance, this is becoming an increasing feature, I would say, across certainly our school estate.
Thank you. Okay, can I now move to questions from Ross Greer, please?
Thanks, Convener. Lynn, I'd like to pick up a little bit, somewhat tangentially, but hopefully this will be a neat segue. Something that you said a moment ago, acknowledging that legislation in Scotland around additional support needs is broad. We have a very broad definition of additional needs, which I think is universal or certainly very widely supported. Clearly, every child or young person with a recognised additional need doesn't require a coordinated support plan, but you'll be aware of the evidence that the committee's heard. Only 0.2-ish% of kids with a recognised need do actually have a plan. So I'd be interested in your perspective and Nicola's in the first instance of, do you recognise the concerns that we've heard from others, that that number is simple and that proportion is simply far too small? Or is there a different explanation here? Do you think it's appropriate that CSPs, there are CSPs for the 1,000-ish kids with the most complex needs, but that actually that's probably the proportion you would expect?
Hopefully straightforwardly, I do accept the concerns, ADES accepts the concerns. We recognise that the CSP gives remedy to particular rights, and we feel that that very strongly has to be in place. We talk frequently about CSPs and feel confident that across our local authorities we do understand the criteria and the process for a CSP. Undoubtedly, the clear issue here is the criteria for a CSP and the need for education to be coordinated across multi-agency partners. And, for example, in my local authority, we devolve the assessment of a coordinated support plan to our headteachers. We ask them to discuss this in child's planning meetings. And for our looked-after children, at child looked-after reviews. And almost always, when the multi-agency team are asked, does this child meet the criteria for a coordinated support plan? You know, we ask, is it the responsibility of the local authority? Yes. Does the child have additional support needs that will be sustained over 12 months? Yes. And almost always the question that is always a no on the checklist is, does this child need intensive support from one or more other agency out with education for longer than a 12-month period? And almost always the response from our multi-agency colleagues is no. We record that on the forum, so we collate that at local authority level, so I'm very strong in terms of my evidence and information, and that would be resonated, I would expect, across other local authorities. So I suppose from an ADIS perspective, yes, we're concerned. We feel strongly that there should be statutory plans that give legal recourse. Of course we do. We very clearly feel it is the criteria specifically with regards to the coordinated support plan. We hope the refreshed code of practice enables us to have some clearer definition on that, and we would also ask that the coordinated support plan and the workload issues for schools, given the multitude of planning documents that we have within our legislation, needs to be reviewed.
I could just pick up on that, Bikin Nicholas' thoughts as well. Do you think that point around, that particularly the 12 months multi-agency issue, point of criteria, can that be addressed? Can we resolve that problem entirely through revising the code of practice, or does that really require actually amending the legislation, what's on the face of the legislation?
I think for me it perhaps might be the legislation. I think what we try to do through codes of practice updates and guidance updates is to re-look at whether the code of practice can make this really clear for local authorities, and we simply haven't cracked it, and the numbers are going down. We know that. We monitor that at an ADES level because we see that. So I think it needs to be, potentially from my point of view, needs to be legislative. There is also case law that the tribunal help with, you know, and we heard from Chloe from Govan Law today, and there was a recent upper tier tribunal decision that again made it really clear to local authority around the criteria of social of coordinated support plans, and they ruled in favour of the local authority around particular points of law. So I think that the evidence is telling us that this is a point of law perhaps rather than code of practice.
Nicola, would Cosler concur with that?
So I wouldn't disagree with anything that Lynn said there from an ADES perspective. I think we've got to recognise that we do have individual support going on within the mainstream here, and that's an important point. I think the other point is that we're not comparing like with like. We've subsequently rolled out counselling in schools. A lot of that counselling would have been picked up by other external agencies. That's now being prepared in school. So I do think there is something about getting underneath the numbers and actually working out what is it telling us. Because if it's telling us that the lack of the support plan is preventing people we need access and support, then that's one thing. If it's telling us that we're dealing with it really well and we don't need it, and I just don't know that we know enough about underneath the numbers on the legislation or code of practice, I'll defer to Lynn on that, given that it's her profession. What I would say is that legislation will only take you so far. We go back to your conversation about prioritisation of resource and the other services. So if we do get legislation changed and we do have more of these plans coming forward, we do need prioritisation in the partner agencies to make sure that the support comes forward.
You mentioned needing to dig into the numbers a bit more, understand the context for them a bit more. Should the CSP review not have done that, the one that took place immediately after the Morgan review?
So I think we do have some of that information there. I would also wonder how contextual that information remains, given where we are now against, you know, it was November 2021. We were probably a bit naive in thinking that the pandemic was finished with us. So I think we do understand where we are, but I would just really be interested in the contextualisation of that, and I think we've started to touch on some of the other stuff that are now the moving parts, the review of curriculum, etc. So always interested in not forgetting where we've got to, but I do think we need to think and dig into it a bit more, is my sense on it.
Thanks.
I could give you another specific example of school counselling as one example. So in the, you know, previous to our new model of delivering school counselling in schools, school counselling would be largely delivered by CAMHS. If they agreed that that counselling was required for a longer 12-month period, that would be intensive individualised support, would meet the criteria yeah. for a coordinated support plan. So that the presumption of mainstreaming and the moving of resources from tiered statutory services to universal services in schools, I think, is one of the reasons why we do have reduced coordinated support plan. Another example would be something that I mentioned in a previous conversation was, for example, speech and language therapy largely offer school staff now consultancy and advice as their service delivery model. In the past, when I started 20 years ago, speech and language therapists would come into schools to deliver the direct intervention to children on a one-to-one basis. If that was happening for over 12 months, they would meet the criteria for a coordinated support plan. What we now have is the consultancy and advice being given and the training being given to school staff, such as our pupil support workers, who now deliver that one-to-one intervention to children in school, therefore do not meet the coordinated support plan criteria. So the evidence tells us that this is a criteria issue rather than any blockage of a local authority to put a CSP in place, which would not be the case at all.
Thanks very much, both of you. That was really useful at surfacing some of these issues, not surfacing, identifying specifically what the core barriers are. If I could ask Vivian and Kerry on this, we know that the single biggest advantage of the CSP is that it gives you a route to redress through the tribunal system. Are there any particular advantages to the child's plan as an alternative? The child's plan doesn't offer that route through the tribunal, but is there anything that, from your perspective at actually delivering this, that makes the child's plan an attractive alternative to a CSP? If we put aside the issues of not being able to tick the box for the 12 months multi-agency intense support, are there situations you think actually a child's plan is more suitable for reason X?
I think that we've heard described really clearly some of the barriers to putting in place a CSP for young people. I think that local authorities are dealing with two competing bits of legislation, you know, the GIRFIC legislation and the ASL Act, and that causes a headache because they don't sit well with each other. GIRFIC, one plan, CSP, but you need another plan if you hit these criteria. I think it is the fact that criteria need to be met at all that sometimes is the barrier to getting planning in place. And so I know that in Fife we would have far, far larger numbers of children with child's plans than we would with CSPs, because you can put a child's plan in place just because the small team around the child agree that we've got a level of planning that we want to record, and so there needs to be no other criteria met than we have decided that we want to write down what the child's assessment needs are and what we're putting in place. So therefore, they're easy to open, they're flexible, they can expand, they can contract, and the criteria have been a barrier, I would say. The other thing is...
Sorry, just to pick up on that, specifically the criteria, the 12 months multi-agency intense support required, or are there other areas where the criteria is not quite matching up with the reality of need?
I would say that's the one that causes the difficulty, because we rely on other agencies to come back to us with their description of what they're going to do that would require coordination and what that specific support is going to be, and we often just don't get that detail, and therefore we can't agree the criteria is met. Whereas in a child's plan, we can just write down what that agency's involvement is. It doesn't need to be specific or intensive or regular or whatever. We can just write down what it is that's been agreed. And therefore, the child's plan often feels like a more functional document that's easier to access. You know, we recognise the need in law for a CSP if the criteria are met, but often we get families saying, we're not sure what the advantage would be. We've got a plan that's coordinating the support around our child. Also, we're very keen that we don't deny the legal redress options to any family, regardless of whether they have a CSP or not. So, for example, we have had a number of families go to tribunal, and we have been engaged in that tribunal process. Very few of those have had a CSP. They've had a child's plan, but you know, the tribunal process has been accessible to them, and we would be very keen to make whatever legal options available to families without them having to, in a way, jump through the hoop of getting the CSP first, planning that they've got in place.
Can I just ask, those families who've used the tribunal process but not had a CSP, is that because they've made a discrimination claim under the Equality Act or a placing request? How have they been able to access
the tribunal? They've made a placing request to an independent special school.
Right, thank you.
Thanks.
Bring yourself in now, please.
You heard me ask earlier about independent adjudication, and the response I got was that part of the reason these processes are little used is that the local authorities don't let people know about them. And in the submissions that this committee has received, I think no local authority has actually mentioned this process. What do you believe to be the reason that independent adjudication is used infrequently, and would COSLA welcome easier routes for parents and families to challenge local authority decisions?
I think it's difficult to comment on why individual local authority submissions didn't include independent adjudication. What I would say is, in the public sector in Scotland, we are absolutely crystal clear that you should be resolving things at the lowest possible level. So I don't think we should be looking for a system that pits parents against local authorities, given that it's children's outcomes that we're looking for there. So I think I'm interested in all of the stuff that we've heard from the professionals on the panel today around about communication. I suspect the independent adjudication point is something that local authorities are well used to. It's not the only part of our business that we're independently adjudicated on. We've got our ombudsman, we've got other bits and pieces, so we are well used to it. I go back to the point I've been making throughout, that communication is always the best thing to do, and make sure that people are aware of their rights. I think the other thing we could do after the independent adjudication is a bit of follow-up around about, you know, I think we've heard that parents might feel that they're in a situation where going down that route is the only route open them to get redress. I think we probably need to have a bit of a conversation about what did that actually feel like, because I think a lot of the time that we end up at independent adjudication, when we do things like joint visits, when we actually dial into the actual needs of the children, we could come up with a very similar situation without going to that. So I'm a big fan of devolving things down, sorting the problems at the lowest possible level, recognising that we do have a need for independent adjudication, and we need to make sure that parents are aware that that's there.
Well, I can't not ask Kerry Drinan then the similar point on behalf of Falkirk Council. Do you have any idea why independent adjudication wouldn't have been mentioned by local authorities?
Probably because we signpost to independent advice first. And so the independent advice and the inquiry contain all of that information about remedies and parental rights, and in a very parent-friendly way. So from that point of view, I believe that that's where there's probably a gap come in. But I also believe that most disputes, if you want to call it that, are to do with parents wanting a placing request to be overturned. So that's not likely to go to independent adjudication. That's more likely to go to a tribunal, because they would have the powers to overturn that. So I think there's just, it's to do with the signposting, it's to do with the advice that's given, and again, it's all we try very hard. We have very, very few, if not a tribunal is very rare for us, because we will try and mediate and work it out and resolve it at school level with the parents first, before it escalates beyond that. So I think we've never probably got to independent adjudication either, as a result of working closely with our families right at the earliest point.
Thank you. Dr. Binney, I'm going to come to you next. I'm just going to press on this, because My Rights, My Say seem to suggest that it's at the local authority's discretion whether or not this progresses, and that there would be no right of appeal. Is that correct? And if so, does that need changing?
Well, as an independent adjudicator myself, recently appointed by the Scottish Government, I think it is a service that is not used at all within the system. I think from a local authority perspective, as Kerry mentioned, we would signpost parents to independent advice, and my hope would be that those independent advisers would indeed advise parents that is an option that can happen. I don't see it in local authorities as a signpost. I think it's probably there in policies and procedures somewhere, but not something we would routinely refer to. Our
our if parents were looking for, you know, if we're unhappy, we would direct them to our stage two complaint process in the main rather than independent adjudication. I don't think it would be correct that local authorities would put any barriers into independent adjudication being accessed. I think the onus, however, the onus is on the parent to make that request to Scottish Government and for Scottish Government then to contact the independent adjudicator and the local authority. So the local authority at that point would agree or disagree whether they would like to go forward with independent adjudication. I wouldn't think there would be any situations where local authority wouldn't want that. An independent adjudicator would then be appointed and basically looks at the evidence on each side and gives advice. So I don't think it's used for a number of reasons, and I think that the Scottish Government were looking to publicise it more to ensure that local authorities understood that that was an option. I don't think it's something that parents necessarily would want. I would think that they would want the Stage 2 complaint process to progress, and we do receive a number of Stage 2 complaints with regard to meeting learners' needs that we're able to resolve at Stage 2. And Stage 2 within local authorities is an independent process. There's an independent reviewer that is asked to review the case and make a judgment. And also parents feel that the parents I've spoke to, small number, that independent adjudication would not give them that legal recourse that they seek. So I think it's a complicated picture that should be reviewed.
I understand. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr, and I would like to thank the panel for your evidence this morning. We will have our final evidence session on this inquiry next week, when we will be hearing from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and we'll then produce a report based on what we have heard with recommendations for the Scottish Government. So this concludes the public part of our meeting, of our proceedings, and I now suspend the meeting to allow our witnesses to leave, and the committee will then move into private to consider our next agenda items. Thank you very much.